colleagues, shall we start? Jan? The Honorable Mr. Albrecht? It's not exactly crowded today, is it? Good morning, everybody. Today we're going to have three sessions, basically. The first one on, let's say, technical stuff, the IT means of protecting our privacy. The second session will be the exchange. No, sorry, we have four sessions. Second session will be the presentation of the working document by the rapporteur, Mr. MORAES, and Mr. Kirkhope. As a shadow rapporteur, and the working document is on the scope of international, European and national security in the EU perspective. And then the third session will be a bit the plaid de résistance, the exchange of views with Mr. GREENWALD, the journalist who published the facts based on the documents of Mr. Snowden. Mr. GREENWALD, who was formerly a journalist of The Guardian and an author and columnist. And then the final session of today will be the presentation of the draft report by the rapporteur, Mr. MORAES, and I understand it will be an oral presentation and there is no text yet, as a few modifications have to be made. Okay, so unless any of you have any remarks to make about the agenda, I suggest that we adopt it. And that we proceed with our first panel. To my left, to my far left, Mr. Bart PRENEEL, Professor in Computer Security and Industrial Cryptography in the University, the Catholic University of Leuven. Very welcome. And to my left, Mr. Stephan LECHNER, the Director of the Institute for the Protection and Security of the Citizen. That sounds very good. Joint Research Center of the European Commission. I'm going to invite you to each make a statement of maximum of 10 minutes each, and then we'll open the floor to questions and answers. Mr. PRENEEL, you have the floor.
Good morning, everybody, and thank you very much for the opportunity to speak here. It's a great honor and pleasure to talk to you about IT means of protecting privacy. So my background is cryptography and information security, and I also do quite some research related to privacy. So I'd like to look at the technical dimensions of protecting systems, and the first thing is security of communication. This is something cryptography has been doing for many thousands of years, and if cryptography is applied correctly, it's actually very effective. And the Echelon inquiry more than 10 years ago also concluded we should use in Europe more cryptography. There are good standards, but they're probably very hard to implement correctly because they're rather complex. And then there is many problems, the things in red on my slide. For example, for our GSM systems, we still have weak encryption because governments decided in the 80s that we don't want to put strong encryption in the pockets of citizens. Encryption is not end-to-end. If you have a wireless LAN, you only encrypt up to the station in the room or in the building, and then everything is in clear again. If you use Skype, there is encryption, but there is no transparency whatsoever about what's being done. And there is also weak implementations, and it has been leaked in the Snowden documents, for example, that NSA has undermined standards for encryption and for key generation. And there is also weak governance and management of the keys. And I just have to mention DigiNotar, the Dutch company, which actually was shown to be completely insecure and actually was a big threat to real users of cryptography in Iran. And there is also problems with routing and domain name services. And it's also very likely that all encryption systems, or a large fraction of them, have backdoors. So the state of the art today is that only a very small fraction of the traffic we have is actually protected by encryption. And then only a very small fraction of that is protected by secure encryption. So in some sense, we're in a very bad situation, and it's not a technology problem. So the second aspect of communication is not what is being said, but who's talking to whom and from where. And this is known as metadata in the Snowden discussions. So who's talking to whom? And for many applications, it's as important to protect this as the content of communications. And there, in contrast to protecting the content, there is few solutions. And there is one which has a reasonable adoption called the Tor system, the onion routing. It has every day about a few hundred thousand users. And we can estimate that the total number of users is a few million. The Snowden documents show that, at least in 2006, NSA was not able to completely undermine it. They could undermine individual users, but not the system as a whole. It's quite a well-managed system. It's actually supported by U.S. government and by several companies. It's not supported very well by Europe. And, of course, there are security limitations. If your opponent is very powerful, or if you go from one side in a country and you're in the same country, the government of that country can typically undermine your privacy. Also, location data. This was revealed a few weeks ago, but it's not so surprising. NSA's Core Traveler program, in fact, once you have such a GSM in your pocket, you have a tracking device in your pocket, and anybody, any government or intelligence agencies can track where you are. And, of course, this is very sensitive because it allows to derive, for example, whether you have certain diseases, if you visit certain hospitals, or it can allow people to derive your religion. I think, in general, regulatory inventions or interventions have not always helped. They frequently have reduced privacy online. For example, you have the Data Retention Directive. And the Parliament voted here and approved here is, in fact, the same thing as metadata collection in the US, about which the press is so upset. And also to many other communication systems, we have added law enforcement interfaces. And as experts say, we believe they will be abused in the future. This is kind of the easy part of security, communications. The hard part is securing the end systems, because communication is something very simple. It's bits on a wire. The end systems are very complex devices with billions of tiny switching elements, transistors. There is millions of lines of code, and there is, again, hundreds of thousands of apps in this, and so it's very difficult to actually make this secure. It's a very complex ecosystem with a history of about 40 years. And a system with billions of components cannot be perfect. So there is actually flaws in there. And these flaws lead to attacks. And what we've learned, again, is that governments exploit those attacks. In fact, some governments are happy with this state of affairs because they actually can attack all the flaws we have in those systems. So a way to deal with this is continuous update, which means that another entity is continuously changing the device in your pocket or on your table. In fact, it means that another entity is in complete control of what you are doing. You have no control yourself because there is a remote update being done all the time. Of course, we also have defensive technologies like firewalls and antivirus, but we all know that they only protect for 50%, 60% of the threats. They don't protect us against well-motivated opponents. I just have to mention Stuxnet to show you that a sophisticated virus can actually undermine any system. So then another problem is the human factor. We see that many threats to IT systems come from insiders who have been bribed, coerced, or blackmailed. And very often, once a powerful person inside the system is a weak link, it's possible to undermine the whole system. Our systems are not designed to deal with weak human links. And then the final concern is supply chain. Our systems are designed in one country, built in another country, and a number of layers are built, like a very complex supply chain, which is very hard to make secure and to control. So in principle, you could check everything, but it's so complex that it is actually uneconomical to do. And so our systems are full of backdoors. So some recommendations on how to improve things. In human factors, my advice is not to advise better training of users, end users, but we need that every IT person should get a training in security. And we also need more IT security experts. IT systems should also be secure and private by default, and it should be very hard for users to actually switch that off. On the legal side, I think we need very strong security and privacy legislation with technical enforcement. It's not enough to shift the responsibility to consent of users or DPAs, data protection authorities, who will take care of us. You have to have protection by technology. And also, of course, substantial fines. It's actually amazing, to my view, as a naive academic, that you can actually offer communication services without offering secure communication services. how can it be that people can sell us services which are not secure? They should be, by default, secure. On technology, we're not ready with everything. We need more work on cryptology, for sure, also more European work. Europe has a very strong position there. But also more work on privacy-enhancing technologies, such as anonymous networking. So the message there, I think, is that if you look at the work plan of Horizon 2020, there is quite some cryptology foreseen. Doing research on privacy-enhancing technologies is a lot harder because it's very hard to find companies for your project. Companies are not interested in this thing because it's not in their economic interests to offer these kind of services. We also want open orbits of systems as a way to get them secure and also rethink IT. So we have to actually have security and privacy by design. And I put it between quotes because this term has been abused and everything is called privacy by design these days. But I think there is an academic community looking at this and trying to define what it means properly. I think we also have to acknowledge that we have to start from scratch for some building blocks. We cannot just keep going on and keep enhancing things and patching things. Some things we have to go back to the drawing board and start again. There is also a very important economic dimension. A lot of the insecurity we have today is due to economic reasons. This is very well understood, what the economic drives behind this are. And solutions for this are standardization. But standardization not of compromises that keep everybody happy and don't make it too secure because that's undesirable for certain governments, but standardization with gold standards, have open processes, not driven by one country. It turns out that in cryptography, for example, the US government and NIST is driving a lot of standardization, and we now learn that NSA is undermining the standardization efforts. So why do we as Europeans with strong crypto researchers don't make our own crypto standards? So I've done an attempt to this. I was running a network of excellence in cryptology, and we published every year a recommendation. Of course, we're just academics, so we can publish an informal recommendation, which algorithms to use. And the good news is that a few months ago, ENISA, European Network Information Security Agency, has copied its recommendations and is now publishing them at the European level. But of course, they have no binding value because that's the next step. If you want to enforce the use of strong European standards, you have to go to procurement in a clever way. So it all comes down to governance and architectures. So you have conflicting views. Governments want access to the communications and the data in our systems for themselves, and they hope that they can do this while precluding others to have access. And I think this is doomed to fail. Some people believe they can do this, but I think lessons of history has taught us that we can't do this. It's just impossible to have a system where one government has access and the others don't. So this is what we have today. So now we have all no security. Industry in a very difficult position because often the government knocks on their door and asks for the data. Okay. On the other hand, they want to protect their own data against industrial espionage, or they want to protect their content, digital rights management technology, protection of movies, of music, and so on. Or they want to protect their software. And then they also, I would say at the third level, they also want to protect the privacy of their users. And so industry has to face this conflict, and I guess you can guess who's the most powerful. And I put them in this order on purpose. And of course, individuals, data protection legislation in Europe is based on consent, but in fact, citizens cannot manage these complex trade-offs. They don't understand this. It's a very complex decision, which even security experts have a hard time to understand. So how can citizens make decisions about this? They just accept anything, or they just abandon technology. That's the only two solutions they have. So I think the bottom line of the problem is that we need to rethink our architectures. It seems to be believed that it's good to store in central places large amounts of raw data and then claim that you can keep it secure. I think we've seen the lessons. We can't keep this secure. So we should not say make it more secure. We should just stop collecting raw data, massive amount of raw data in central places. And this is a way of rethinking our architecture, because what we do is we create a single point of trust. We say company X will behave properly, company X will not misbehave. But in fact, it turns out that we create a single point of failure. And we have seen failures repeatedly, so it's not a surprise that there will be more failures. Second thing is also, you have to have data minimization. You should design your architecture so that there is as few data collected as needed and only high quality data. And then finally, we can only enforce this with transparency and open community review. closed systems will always do more than is allowed to them is desirable. So come to my last slide, my recommendations. We should, as Europe, invest more in defense than in offense. Look at the framework programs on Horizon 2020. I don't have time to study the amount, but I think it's a question the European Parliament and the Commission have to ask themselves. How much money have they spent on surveillance and how much on privacy? What is the ratio? I think the ratio is between 20 and 100. Okay? So privacy is the excuse, surveillance is the norm, and this is where the European research money in this area is spent. Second, we need open technologies. What we see today is we cannot trust closed technologies. There are backdoors in there, and we can't even find them. It's not because something is open source there is no backdoors. Probably some governments have put backdoors in open source. But at least in open source, we have a chance, if we have resources and efforts, to actually find them and remove them. In closed source, we have no chance whatsoever to find them. Third thing is rethink architectures. Okay, don't assume that this is the way it should be. We have to collect in one large place raw data about everything you do, every click, every location you are, every interaction you have. This is not needed. This is just some companies benefit from this in their business models, but our society does not need to be constructed that way. We have to do more research on how to do it differently. There is no off-the-shelf solution. For every problem, we need to rethink about this. And then my final recommendation, try to use procurement wisely to have more secure and private systems. Governments have enormous power to make sure that vendors come with secure solutions. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Mr. Lechner, you have the floor for about 10 minutes.
Thank you very much. I would like to just give a little bit of an introduction coming from the Joint Research Center, the scientific arm of the European Commission. I'm working in network security since 1989. I'm a mathematician and cryptographer by education. I've worked for software vendors in industry and for telecommunications operators being confronted with requests from governments. And I'm now heading a research center on the very same protection and security of the citizen within the European Commission as a scientific service. The headline that I was given here was better protection for EU institutions, so this is just a very small fragment. But we have in mind, what would we have to do to protect us better if we're reading this question? And we're automatically having the reflex of thinking about solutions. In principle, the starting point is somewhere else. The starting point is if you want to be protected better, then you need to know what you want to protect yourself against. And this is a professional approach to managing risks in all different types of dimensions, and also here. So in principle, the methodology is always the same. You start by looking at the threat, but the threat might not be relevant for you because you might not be vulnerable. But you need to understand also your vulnerabilities. Then if you understand the threat and the vulnerabilities, you need to estimate what kind of impact would it have, because it might have little impact. You're highly vulnerable, there's a threat, but the impacts might be little. And then you can only come to the total risk. The next step after that is to look into what to do against the risk, and then there is a sixth step usually, what to do with the residual risk, but I'm not going to go into this. So in principle, we should start with the threat here, and I will just walk you through my perception of the threat, the vulnerabilities, the impact, the risk, and then come quickly to the conclusions. So on the threat itself, we're having strong indications, but I do not have substance. This is just Mr. Snowden. This is what is published by press, what we all can read. But all the materials or most of the materials are classified. If you're looking into the few declassified documents, you will see that still large areas are blacked out. So as a matter of fact, we do not know a lot, but we have strong indications. There has not been a clear denial, and that project indeed is huge. We can understand that there have been more than 30,000 technically skilled persons working for three decades with billions of dollars on one common goal with minimum supervision. So with the mission of gathering intelligence, what would you expect them to come up with? So the threat, I need to be careful here, seems very huge, but this is hard to prove because we have indirect evidence only. The vulnerabilities, in turn, comprise all different kinds of technologies that we're having today. Everything. The hardware, the software, the applications, the middleware, the operating systems. Even the computer games I recently learned from press. So the vulnerability side is far simpler than the threat side. If the threat is taken for serious, the vulnerabilities are there. So modern information technology is completely exposed. And I'm not talking about a unilateral exposure, only about US-American technologies that can come from anywhere. So let's take a look at the impact now. We have two sides here. One is loss of privacy, which in Europe is important because we're talking about fundamental citizen rights that cannot be waived. The second thing is more technical. This is loss of sensitive information. So it is not so much the needle in the haystack problem here, but it's also if you got the haystack, you could come up with ideas to find your own needles that you are interested in without searching for particular criteria. You should just take a look at politicians that are runners-up in elections. And then all of a sudden, if there is any story about them coming out, and it's in press and the sources of press are well protected, where might it come from? So you can take indirect political influence if you do not want to spot the needle in the haystack by certain criteria, but if you have already spotted your needle and then you're digging in the haystack to find something about it. And that also holds, of course, for industrial needles in this type of industrial espionage. So let's now come to a simplified consideration on risk. So this is kind of very rough rule of thumb. So you multiply the threat, the vulnerability, and the impact, and then you have an idea about the risk. And as we have seen, the threat is high, the vulnerability is high, and the impact is significant. And I would not even want to look at the technical impact only. I would also look at the liberty rights of European citizens that are at stake here. So then it's time to look into the countermeasures, not starting with the countermeasures. So in principle, we do have quite a strong idea about network and information security in Europe. We have created the ENISA agency. We have a European research community, and they're busy with different programs, problems since the late 80s at least. So we have cybersecurity in many companies and organizations as a top management issue. We have security awareness, and we got all this technical stuff that I don't want to dive into detail. But this can be improved. If I'm taking a look at how serious we're taking that, then there is still a lot of room to move. And even if we completed all these things throughout Europe and in European institutions, and we had a very security-minded user society there, and we had the perfect organization and top management awareness, that might only raise the bar, because the threat is so huge. We could really do what we're doing today using cellular, mobile cell phone encryption, and being fully aware that the encryption algorithm has been broken years ago. But there is nothing else that we could choose here easily. So all the different things that we could apply typically might not be sufficient. additional options in turn are difficult. So this is what we could at first glance look into. So just eliminate non-EU technologies, or do not use non-EU technologies in a way that we would use them before. But working for the European Commission, I've been running around with an iPhone for 2 years where I could not install a single app. Can you consider how dumb that feels? I mean, we're shutting ourselves out of the most recent technology trends, and doing like that, we might have significant disadvantages in the competitive position of Europe. We could, and by the way, it is not really said that all European technologies are secure, because European governments also have justified interests of national security, and they are having their intelligence agencies that have the very same mission of gathering information. So, one way ahead, but not the perfect one. EU-wide strong encryption, which in the sense of Mr. Preneel means trusted encryption, transparent encryption, and hard encryption, and encryption for everyone. But then we're immediately running into export control issues, because also encryption algorithms can be classified as military goods. We could verify also products in terms of security, but this is a nightmare. Billions of lines of codes in applications that are permanently changed by automatic updates. If we switch off our cell phone, we cannot even see if it's really switched off. It's just the display going dark. I mean, we have zero control about the technologies. We just seem to have a little bit of control. If we do not have automatic updates, the vendors coming from all around the globe will tell us that we are getting security problems because we do not fix the security vulnerabilities. If we do have the updates, we do not actually know what we're installing. So the political and the legal frameworks are of real significance here. Many, many issues that I've mentioned, I just wanted to say on additional options, they will not be simple. So my conclusions preliminarily here, because the story will be ongoing. We do have reasonable protection, and it could be increased, and it should be increased. But, and this threat is different, the reasonable protection that we're having is not tailored against the threat that we're facing now. It is tailored against the bread and butter, day-to-day operations, keeping hackers off, running 30,000 attacks on a server every day, and trying to cut them down to not let anybody get through. But it's not tailored against somebody who might be colluding with the software or hardware vendors and force them under national law to not talk about what they have done together, because everything is classified and not for foreign nationals. So this threat is huge, and we cannot exclude anything for sure. We cannot exclude that this or that technology might have been broken in the meantime. We might have seen from indirect sources that the Tor issue was still not somehow broken in 2006. But ladies and gentlemen, this is 7 years ago. So standard countermeasures might not be sufficient for the threat. And the bad news is the global connectivity will grow in the future, so we cannot really escape. We cannot isolate Europe from non-European technologies. We cannot live on what we trust, and we do not know if within Europe we can trust each other. In that sense, of course. So my principal conclusion here, the problem is very complex and cannot be solved quickly. So if you're looking at European institutions, we're doing all we can. I know a lot of security officers. I've been security officer myself for a company, and it's a reasonable way to protect companies that we're doing today, but you need to tailor to the threat, and you should not tailor to something that you have just put in place without thinking how big, huge, or complex the threat really can be. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, both of you, for very interesting, useful, and slightly worrying presentations. And I just noted this morning, as I was walking down the corridor to this meeting room, that there are printed notices up on the walls everywhere by the European Parliament IT service saying that they've taken down the or disabled the Wi-Fi following the story of the hacker, and somehow I'm just getting more and more worried if I listen to this. But I think there are two important conclusions that we can draw also on the basis of previous panels, is that we need to invest a lot more in our own protection when it comes to technology. But the more difficult problem to solve is the political one, as governments have, well, at the very least, a double agenda. Okay, I'm going to open the floor to questions and answers, and we start with the rapporteur and the shadow rapporteurs, Mr. MORAES.
Thank you very much to both of you for the contribution, and I hope, I mean, given the sophistication of your contributions, that these questions are, well, certainly my question is not too naive and simple, but we have had a number of experts now, IT experts, talking about Tor and other issues, but my question is very simple. My colleagues have more expertise in this area, but I just want to ask about the parliamentary security and our issues here. Can I just ask you for an assessment of this? We had colleagues talking about issues, for example, with Microsoft not even having server-to-server encryption. If you do encrypt, that can be hacked now. And, you know, the fact is there is no 100% protection. So what is appropriate for our institutions in terms of the threat level that you're talking about? I mean, should we really... I mean, we have to be a transparent institution. Democratic institutions have to be transparent. We have to have a certain level of security. But what is what is your assessment of where we should be sitting in terms of our security as a sort of democratic institution or set of institutions? And how much protection should we have, given that there is no such thing as 100% security? And then where should encryption sit with that level of security? Should we really be being aggressive with it, or, you know, where would you pitch it?
Thank you. I'm going to ask the panelists to respond, but be very concise, because we have more people and we have until 10 o'clock for this session.
Yeah, very quickly. I don't see a conflict between transparency of a democratic institution and security, because the transparency you can always create by just informing the public about what you're doing. The security, in turn, keeps these things from leaking out on a way where they're premature or not being really finished. So this is a completely different story. So the transparency and the security in that sense is not a conflict. What I think we could do, but we are far from being technical now capable of installing that right away, is having our own protected, secure application on top of all the untrusted IT stacks and the service and everything, such that we would have a European trusted and open source product that would create end-to-end encryption between the parliamentarians talking to each other, and probably also between the contacts that they're having in the political world. The whole stack of technology is kind of broadly to be not trusted. We can only solve that problem technically if you put something on top that creates an end-to-end secure channel. That would be, in a nutshell, an answer.
I think it's a very difficult problem to make something really secure. I mean, but it's clear that you can protect communications, as my colleague says, I agree, but then your data is still in the end systems. If somebody uses an iPhone, then the data ends up anyway in Cupertino, right? So you really have to have your own systems, and you have to have them audited and have open source, and you have your own standards. You first would have to even agree on what European security standards would be, or whether you can come to global standards. I think you can take some ad hoc measures, like every company does. They have a basic security level, a baseline, but you will not protect against governments going after you. If you want to do this, then you really have to start from scratch or rebuild your infrastructure.
Thank you. Mr. Voss?
I would like to talk in German.
Well, even if you've had an inkling that a great deal is possible these days, what we've heard from you really is confirming what we already knew. Over and above this inkling, it's this idea that you have the feeling that you're completely impotent to the developments we're seeing. When we're talking about the private sphere, but also on security, and in this technological world, somehow it's difficult to draw up the borders, to establish borders. And from what you're saying, this seems to be almost impossible. I don't know if that's the right impression I've got from what you've said, but at least it seems extremely difficult and would involve a massive amount of input to achieve that. So if I've understood correctly, perhaps what we ought to be doing is looking to have more decentralization. That's what I've noted. And I'd like to ask, above and beyond that, not only those people who are meant to be picking up off the street because they're criminals, but people who use technology fair and square. Both sections of the populace are using the same technology. Can we define borders? Can we create delineations in technical terms where we can say, well, okay, this door can only open up if there is a setup that enables that because they're organized criminals or because they've done something that they're not allowed to do? Or do we need to go through the legals, down the legal path? Or is it more a question of morals and ethics, if there's basically a common will to restrict society in this way? I find this quite difficult to get my head around, I have to admit. But this idea of controlling yourself and making sure that things don't happen purely through collective will is something that's a bit difficult to do. Where would you see possibilities where we can draw up these borders, these delineations? I find it very difficult to grapple with.
Mr.
Lechner?
Well, I apologize if I answer in English because I work for a European institution.
I would like to answer in English, as I'm working for a European institution. That is most straightforward to me. Sorry about that. The question is difficult enough. I think technologically it is really, really hard to tell from the use of the internet or modern technologies by criminals or by normal people, because criminals and non-criminals are using the internet in the very same way. They're using the iPhones and the apps, and they're texting, and they're doing their business, whatever that business might be. So technically, I'm seeing severe difficulties in having a line that says, here's a cutoff, and this is what we can do. We can, of course, work on a data retention idea and cut this down, but this is just a lever that we would move to the other side, and the less we have technical opportunities, the more we will get into the way into justified police work or anything like that. So I think you are perfectly right saying the real idea that we have to follow is legal protection, constitutional protection of baseline constitutional rights. Unfortunately, that legal protection is excavated by all different types of exceptions. So, also in Germany, under certain circumstances, there are classified accesses to data that are justified and that supersede the Federal Data Protection Act. So all these legal exceptions have now flourished, and we have seen in the United States how far that can go. Because I think the US could claim that most of their activities are on a solid legal basis within their own governance. But they're working on all the different exceptions that they have filed for reasons of homeland security, for reasons of the fight against terror. So legally, it will be very difficult to challenge that. And the legal baselines have to be changed to get back to safe grounds. But that will still not keep people from sidestepping the legal baselines, working in a gray zone, or just doing something illegally. So we really have a severe problem here. Quick answer, technically I would consider it impossible to just draw a line here and say this is a good side, this is a bad side. Legally it will be very difficult, and ethically we should live up to the European basic constitutional values should maintain them, but it will not help us in the political debate a lot.
Entschuldige mich, dass ich nicht auf Deutsch antworte.
Well, I won't answer in German either.
But I think, can we have security? I think yes, but we have to have a rupture. We have to understand that we can't go with business as usual. We have to change our approach and look at the new architecture. And I think, of course, this will be driven by legislation or governance, because it's not going to come automatically. And I think there is a big gap there between what's happening in real life and the legal desires. And it's very difficult to find analogies, but if you look at new technologies or changes in the medical world, there is a body of experts or scientific experts who say, this is how we should go. This is the new approach. Well, the problem today is, where's the expertise? Expertise is in governments, but they have multiple interests, industry. So I think we should also have advisory boards by scientists who tell legislators and society where to go. They should not make decisions, but they should at least say, this is possible. So then on the trade-off, of course, law enforcement on the back of terrorism also want to do their job and want to actually get access to more data. But the question is, in the current model, what we see is kind of an oil spot. It keeps going out. They want more and more. In the current architecture, it's very hard to limit the access. You give them something and they want more and more. In the end, they have everything about everybody. And they can justify this. But that's not a society where I want to live. So I think we should have a different architecture. I think we should, in this architecture, take into account legitimate needs of governments and law enforcement, but I think in the current architecture, in the current way we've built the world, I don't think it's possible to limit them. And at the very least, we have to have more transparency about what's happening.
Okay, thank you. I'm changing hats now. I'm now speaking on behalf of the other group. I have three questions. Following on from the question of Mr. Vos and your replies to that. I find it somehow hard to believe that we cannot apply the same principles in the online world that we're applying in the offline world. In the offline world, we accept that people have locks on their doors. We accept that people have a right to keep the state out, unless they are suspect of a crime or terrorism or whatever. In that case, police can do a home search, for example, but everybody has the right to lock their doors. You have the right, when you send a letter, to close the envelope. We have the right to do that. We have the right to protect our privacy. So, and I like what you said about we need to look at a new architecture and maybe, well, not start from scratch, but look at new ways of doing things, because I think that we should have the right to protect ourselves from you know, anybody, including governments, entering our private sphere, just as we have in the offline world. And I was wondering, you say it's technically very difficult. I'm sure that it is, but surely it's not impossible. I mean, if I see what we can do, but I'm a technological zero, so maybe I overestimate it. Second question is, you know, I always like to think in terms of opportunities rather than threats. When we say this is all very difficult and protection and encryption and what have you, but can't we just look at it as an economic challenge? Isn't there huge potential for European companies to develop new ways of protecting ourselves, to develop new standards, as you have both indicated? And do you see in your, let's say in your circles, do you see that European companies are now using the momentum, you know, after all the revelations, of investing in this kind of research? And then finally, this is a question to the both of you, but maybe also to the Secretariat, because one of you raised an issue that I wanted to ask, is about EU funding for research and development in this area. Do we have an overview? I think you mentioned it's 20 to 100, or okay. But I'd like to ask the Secretariat if the study department can can find out. Yes, but I'd like to know exactly in Horizon 2020 or any other kind of European funding, how much we spend on the protection of our data. So I don't know which one of you wants to answer first.
So on the first question, of course, it's always very nice to look at the physical world because it's something we understand easily. But you should understand that the average lock of a house can actually be opened in a few seconds. And also the same thing with a car lock. The police can get in there in a few seconds. This is why they don't mind. In fact, and what they'd prefer to do is get into a car or a house and put a bug or search it without you even knowing this. And this is why the police is very happy with the current situation. If you would have a very strong protection where even the military can't get in, where you would start building bunkers with explosives and so on, then in principle it would be okay, but it's just too expensive. Now, the problem is in the digital world, if you have very strong security, in fact, it's very strong and the government can't get in, the military can't get in, NSA can't get in. If you build your own hardware, your own open source system, then they'll have to compel you to give your data. So I think they're much happier with the current situation where the baseline is insecure. They can get in anyway, and some people who have encryption believe that they have it, but in fact they have many backdoors into it. It's more than the situation. Of course, if you're going to improve security, which we recommend, it will be harder to have backdoors.
No, but if I may interrupt, that's exactly. I wasn't asking about the, you know, the political possibility, because we know what the challenges are, but is it technically possible? And of course, there may not be 100%, but can we make it so much more difficult for governments that it becomes, you know, not interesting anymore? And then, can it then be broken in specific cases where there is a concrete suspicion of criminal activity?
So this is very difficult to do. I think that's a problem. I think making something which is very secure, this is okay, but then giving government backdoor access, this is very difficult to do. If it was easy to do, then I think NSA would have done it already, right? Because now, if you look at the US situation, US companies are also vulnerable. They're also using insecure systems, and there is other nations that are exploiting those weaknesses. So it's very difficult to do. I think there was an academic paper about this in the 90s when the US government tried to push key escrow and the Clipper chip, and then many flaws were pointed out by academics in the proposed design. I'm not saying it's impossible, but I think it's, again, an order of magnitude more difficult than building a secure system. And we're already far from that, or this is already a big challenge. It's not impossible, but I think it's going to require a long-term research effort and study effort, and it's definitely not trivial. But at least you can have more accountability and more transparency about it. Should I go to the second question, or should we?
Yes.
So the second question, is this an economic opportunity? Of course, there is European companies who try to jump into this and try to do something. In that sense, there can be some benefit for Europe. But of course, what they do is limited in the sense that if you look at where the control of the hardware is designed in the US, it's built in the East. And then many layers of systems are already under complete non-European control, so you can add applications on top, but this has limitations. So you can do something, but the endpoints are the weak point. Even if you would build European secure encryption, if you don't control the endpoints, or maybe people remember this, that a couple of years ago, suddenly a large part of traffic in the world went to China. Because you can do this on the internet. You can just reroute all the traffic to a different country, and the Chinese said, oh, I'm sorry, a mistake. Of course, we never know it was a mistake or just a test to see that system worked. But so if you don't change those systems, those building blocks, it's very hard to come with European solutions. But I think the European industry is looking into this, but what they can do is quite limited. And then the other thing is, are European governments prepared to buy those things in their procurement, or will they buy the cheaper system? Are they willing to invest more? And then the question about EU funding, I think it's very difficult to get the numbers. Also, part of the research is classified, but of course, Europe also funds military research, research on satellites and so on. So it's very difficult to get estimates on this. But it's clear that there is large programs on this, on surveillance and protection of borders. And I'm not saying you shouldn't protect your borders, it's just where is the balance in surveillance and protection? And my argument is go more for the defensive side.
Thank you. Mr. Lechner?
All right. I'll try to keep that short as I can. The first question on the technology. There is a severe difference, major difference between the real world and the digital world, as the digital world is not material. So if somebody is breaking into your lock or trying to get into your car, or if anybody is invading your physical privacy, there is a risk of being detected. If you're invading digital privacy, obviously there is very, very little risk of the whole thing being detected at all. If somebody is stealing your goods, they are gone. If somebody is copying your data, they are still there. They're just also there in a different place. So we cannot really transform the idea, the notional idea of having technical protection in the physical world in the very same way to an immaterial cyber world where things just work a different way. The best example for there cannot be a very good complete protection is the fact that was yesterday reported in the newspapers that even the NSA cannot detect how much data Mr. Snowden has taken because they had not fully installed the security controls that they should have had. So in principle, this is a very tricky question. There will be some baseline recommendations soon from a joint technical working group of the European Standardization Organization, CEN, CENELEC and ETSI, who have built a common group on cybersecurity coordination. The things will probably come out still in December or early January, and that report will suggest some technical ideas of how to build European encryption or go for it and have European identities all across the internal market that would then come to the business opportunity that you're mentioning. So business opportunities, second question. I think we do have a good opportunity here because the United States, after that debate, are quite distrusted. China, anyway, is a little bit particular in these things, and Europe, based on the idea of being united in diversity, on the idea of a common set of constitutional baseline rights, can make a big step ahead here and position itself. For the European companies in the market, it will be very difficult because typically in the 80s, security was something that came on top of IT systems, whereas today it is all integrated. And it's integrated into all the Cisco, Intel, Facebook mechanisms that we know. So it will be very difficult to get something that would be a chance for European industry as we're so depending on non-European vendors. Should we want to cut this off or push it back, we would again exclude ourselves from the most recent technological developments, which would not be simple either. So I think the market opportunity has significantly seized by a knowledgeable European community in the industry already. But as there is little particular security demand from users, it is not really an addressable market. My personal perception is that you can only differ by security if you're doing something wrong and people do not trust you, and then you will be swept off the market. It's very hard to differ positively selling something saying you're more secure, because this is not well measurable. So there is an opportunity for Europe politically, and there is an opportunity for Europe in general, but I would very much question a particular market opportunity.
Okay. Mr. Albrecht, Mr. Kirkhope has disappeared.
Thank you very much. Thank you for being here, and I think that all what you have said is quite important. But I think the problem is that we already know it's complicated. So this would be the situation where we really would need some three, four ideas what we can do as politicians. And I mean, you lined out some parts where you think that there are opportunities, but I think it would be really good to have that fixed on some concrete measures which we should improve while knowing that we will never get at the moment where we would like to be. So I think that the next steps would be very important. And I very much like the conversation about the house lock and the, I mean, the conclusion at the moment only can be that the solution is a legal and political one. I understand that completely, because if I can break the house lock and there is no legal boundary or no political agreement that there's a right to lock my house and that there is a line which the police or whomever should not cross, and that there are security standards for locks to be fulfilled on the market, I think then, I mean, this is the most important to have. And the problem with the house lock is that I think when you go on the street and break a house lock, people will see you. While doing that in the technical environment, obviously that's not the case. So that's why you call for transparency. But I would really like to know, is there any opportunity to make this breaking of security safeguards visible? Is there a way to expose this to the public, or at least people who could see it? Is there technical means we could install to see if somebody broke or if there is a possibility to break into a system, so that at least there could be a political discussion or discussion in society about what's going on? Because I think that this is the most problematic at the moment, that nobody sees what's happening, actually happening. I mean, you see it, obviously, but others don't. So those are my two questions. Thank you.
Right, these are good points. First question on the concrete recommendations. I would really advise to wait for a couple of days or limited number of weeks for the Sensenelec ETSI cybersecurity coordination group recommendations, because they will be quite concrete. By the way, the group is chaired by a European parliamentarian, so probably that will be out very soon. The problem is, if I wanted to send an encrypted email from my private account to you, it wasn't possible in Europe today. And if it was possible, I would use whatever kind of US-American encryption provider that I would not know if I could trust. But we are talking here about European institutions, so the only thing that we can do in the European institutions is raise the bar and take the technical means, like encryption of files that are stored on a server and encryption of communications that are around today, and perhaps politically strengthen the research on these issues. But there is little we can really technical do from today to tomorrow without having a dedicated effort in Europe that changes the architecture, as Mr. Prenneel has said. The police line, the second question, making attacks visible, this is very difficult. Believe it or not, but technologically, even if you could make an attack visible, it would be extremely difficult to find the originator. Because there are concepts like botnets, where people are working on behalf of others, and then you might even point into the wrong direction if you're looking at the originator. And you might point at victims that have been utilized by themselves, whereas the whole perpetrator is in a different place. So there is two things that are even more to be considered when moving from that physical world into the digital world. One thing is, the attack is kind of like depositing a bomb somewhere in a very unsuspicious item that could blow up then when the perpetrator is not there anymore. The second thing is that perhaps police might be kept from invading our privacy. But what about the intelligence services? If you have a legal basis that is excavated to the extreme, and we have exceptions here and there and everywhere, then we can work really for a very solid legal basis, sell that as a big success to the citizen, and they will still be exposed. The NSA is not police, and they are not working on the legal basis that would hold for US state police. So this is also extremely tricky. In the physical world, additionally, if I want to break into anybody's house, place, or car, I would have to physically be there, which means my resources do not scale. In the digital world, as we have seen, I just need few stuff to monitor a very large number of people. So it's not only that I would have to leave evidence, and I can also spare off all the physical effort. So this thing is really, really different, and I think technically, it is impossible to get back to the originators of that threat. The only thing that we're doing is we discover by a whistleblower today what we could have guessed that was going on for years already.
So I want to add, I try to give some recommendations. Maybe I could make them more concrete. First one is go for European crypto standards. European research projects develop European standards, and then Europe looks to the ceiling because crypto is a national competence, and then the Americans standardize or do not standardize our algorithms. There is no agency which has the power to do this. If it would exist, it would have a major impact on the market and also influence what is being done. This is still a national competence, and countries should collaborate there. Same thing for metadata. There is very little research funded on protecting metadata. Europe does not fund Tor. It's actually the Navy that funds Tor, and some U.S. defense organizations fund. But Europe does not fund Tor. And of course, I know Tor can be abused, but fund it, also review of open source projects, make euros available so people review the security of open source code for security. And then finally, as already mentioned, procurement. In the end, make it say that reviewed or secure things have to be procured. Governments can buy insecure systems that will drive the market. This is also what happens in other countries if you want to move to security. I don't have much to add to the extensive comments of my colleague on the law to the physical analogies is very difficult to transfer. If you want to detect that somebody has been tampering with it, you have to have a secure system. And if you have a secure system, people will not tamper with it in the first place. So there is techniques for secure logging, where you would at least log what's happening. You would not know who it is. And also, it brings privacy problems. So I guess maybe we should rather take the other approach, and those who actually get access to our systems with legal exceptions, they should be monitored and surveilled. So you actually need surveillance for government agencies or those who surveil others, so that in fact, after a few years, we can check what they did and they know they will be accountable.
Okay, thank you. Thanks. Okay, I have, as Mr. Kirkhope came back and he left again, I have two more speakers on my list. I'm going to take both of them and then ask the panelists to answer briefly. We're overrunning a little bit, but we should have enough time for the second panel. Mr. Engström and then Mrs. Lopez, and then we come back to the panelists, and then we close this session. Mr. Engström.
Thank you. Well, first of all, I'd like to say thank you for excellent presentations. But I mean, the problem is it's too big a problem. What you're saying is that we cannot trust closed source, in particular if it's developed in the US. And that makes perfect sense to me. I mean, obviously, since we don't know what the computer code is doing, we can't trust it. But I mean, in practice, that means that we cannot trust Windows, we cannot trust Mac, we cannot trust iPhone, and we cannot trust Android. That's a big problem. And then, if I understand, it even goes to the hardware layer. All the routers on the internet, I don't know how many million there are in Europe. I mean, we all have to replace them by open source products that aren't really available at all. I think I understand the problem, but I mean, it's too big. I don't really see a solution. So sort of, where should we start? And another thing, we're talking about the threat. I mean, you focused on data theft, or well, it's not theft because it's copied, but I mean, private data being copied, etc. Are there also other risks? I'm concerned that either, well, the U.S. government or some government or terrorists or criminals that get access to these backdoors, is there also a risk that they could disrupt our infrastructure to knock out the internet or the electricity supply or the water supply or do things that you would normally need military attacks to achieve. Is that also a threat?
Mrs. Romero Lopez.
Gracias. Muchísimas gracias.
Thanks very much. And thanks very much for this information, which is extremely useful for this committee of inquiry. Now, despite the technical difficulties, well, there's a question that comes to mind about metadata. You said that for metadata, there's no real research. I think the sea change has come because metadata have been seen as a source of information about what consumers do. It's not seen as private information any longer because it's metadata. So if you're in your email or a telephone information is used just to find out how many times you've emailed certain people, how many times you've used your phone, that's not deemed to be private data. And that's the problem. If we take it that this information is private, the problem arises in justifying why people can have access to the metadata. Because in European constitutions, it would be this wouldn't be allowed. To justify this kind of searching, you need to have a court order. Or you would need to, because there'd be no grounded suspicion. Now, of course, they say, well, that there are Syrian terrorists which justify PNR. But we have absolutely no idea how many Syrian combatants there are in Europe and how many attacks they could perpetrate. We need some kind of justification to pay out for this expensive PNR system. So my question is, are metadata covered by the right to privacy of individuals in the EU? Because if they are, companies simply can't use them unless they have got a court order. And if we sort out that problem in the US and is covered by the Constitution, then we wouldn't have a problem. Because there's this technological discovery, and it's been used to invade people's privacy. So the question is it banned? Is it allowable? If it is banned, then you need a court order. I mean, you can carry out as much research or investigation as you want. But I think it's far better and far more efficient, politically speaking, to say constitutionally this is not on. I don't know if you share my viewpoint at all. Thank you.
Yes, the first point, I mean, it's indeed what we're saying is that if you have to change everything, it's indeed a major change. But I think it's a question for us to decide. Do we just want to keep going on as if nothing happened because it's a major change? Or do we say this is the moment, we should grab the momentum and make the change we need? And by the way, Android is open source. And Android phones tend to be slightly less secure because there is not enough research, but in fact, it's an open source approach. So there is actually, it's not that you have to throw out all the phones, but probably we should invest more money in make the open source versions more secure. So, and it's the same thing with hardware routers. Yes, if you know you have bug routers, you can do two things. You can throw your hands in the air and say, okay, seven nations in the world can eavesdrop all our communications, and it's too expensive to change, so this is what we'll do. But of course, you don't see the hidden cost of industrial espionage or Airbus losing contracts or whatever. So I think there is also many hidden costs, plus the cost to the privacy of your citizen. Is there a value for this? So I think, yes, it's not because experts say it's difficult, it's complex and expensive that we should just throw up their hands in the air. I think we should actually go for it. And we have strong researchers. It's a potential for industry. But I think we need political support, and there will also be financial support needed. It's not going to happen automatically. So then active attacks, of course, this is the next level. So we started from cybercrime, then cyberterrorism, and the next step will be cyber war. And again, the US has made it very clear in public statements that they have now added a cyber war force, and this force will not be only defensive. And I think if you want an example, Stuxnet. Stuxnet has actually damaged nuclear centrifuge, enrichment centrifuge in Iran. Well, we don't have hard evidence, but clear indications of this. This is the next step. Of course, an intelligence agency will typically only do passive things because that makes it easier for them to be hidden, but they will also be able to do active attacks. And so I think this is a very big threat because civilian and military infrastructure will merge. It will be a very difficult threat for society how to deal with this, because you can't have the military running all your iPhones, right? Or all your water plants and all your electricity plants. But I think there is definitely something to look at. There is other reasons than industrial espionage or other nations spying. There is also your economy, your infrastructure be protected, yet another reason to go for more security and make a phase change. Don't just go with business as usual. So then the third question on metadata, I mean, I'm not a lawyer, okay? So it's clear for me as a technician that metadata can be used to identify you personally. There have been research papers that show that if you have somebody's location at two times in a day, then you can identify this person uniquely. So if you just know two locations in a city plus a time, then this can only be one person if you have this information. So in some sense, with some effort, you can go from metadata to real data. And as I mentioned, it can allow you to find out who your friends are. It can be you can find out which hospitals you visit, so which diseases you have, which religion you have. So a lot of highly sensitive data can be derived from metadata. I think the claim that metadata is not sensitive or is not private data, I don't understand this claim as a technician. But of course, it's a legal discussion whether it's legally properly defined, but I think it should be protected as much as any other data. Then on your comment, should companies need a court order to get this data? No, they need consent. If you install a new app, even if it's an app to shine with a light with your phone, this app will say, I want your location. And as a user, you have two decisions. You say yes or no. If you say no, you have no light to shine. If you say yes, then this app will actually collect your location and start storing it. But you get consent. This is the European legal principle. You get consent to do this. And so then now you no longer have protection.
Right, Mr. Angstrom, thanks for the technology question and for the question for clear advice. I can say that we should work on European infrastructures that at least give us a better protection. So we could have European versions of open source operating systems like Android, which are clearly to be certified as being genuine and not having a backdoor. For that, we would need a European public key infrastructure of all the certificates ending somewhere in the root. And we have successfully done such a project already for all European tachographs that we're having on board the trucks. So we are running the root certification authority in the joint research center, so it is possible. It is just a question if there is a political will to get instruments like that installed as a European identity across all European member states, a digital identity that is certified and that can be used also for business within the internal market. So technically, encryption is one thing, European encryption, open source data is a second thing, and certification and public key infrastructure is the third thing. If I look at the implementation of the digital signature directive that we used to have in the years back in time and how that spread out and didn't work, I think we have not done the best possible job those days. We might be able to do better in the future. Critical infrastructure protection, your second question, is currently an issue. Stuxnet is one proof that things can work. We should also ask ourselves if it was done so professionally, why was it released or why has it been detected? And probably that was also flexing the muscles. But there are already technologists, operators of critical infrastructures working on these issues. Even the US have issued a presidential directive or executive order 3636 for the information technology protection of critical infrastructures. And NIST is working on that currently, but it's difficult to tackle also for them. The expert community is well aware of the threat, is working on it with, let's say, reasonable progress. Ms. Romero-Lopez, thanks a lot for the question. My Italian permits to understand your question in Spanish, but I need to answer in English. The metadata, not being a lawyer, but should also be covered by the European basic constitutional right on privacy, because they admit conclusions about our individual behavior. So I think legally, as far as I've seen, they are covered, and I can tell you that in Germany, they definitely are covered by privacy laws. The problem is, again, the excavation of privacy laws in all different ways. not only that there are superseding laws for national security purposes, but also that the free will of the user is just creating an exception. And this is exactly the consent that Mr. Pranil has been talking about. That leads us to click on yes automatically by reflex after 2 milliseconds, even if the terms and conditions to be accepted is 20 pages. And that is what has gone terribly wrong, because the idea from the real world that I need to give my consent, and I need to do that in writing, and in the digital world I can do it by a click, that has been moved apart dramatically. So if I'm reading a contract and I sign it, I'm giving my consent, that is okay. But the counterpart in the technical world has deteriorated that concept completely. It has been going on so long that even for a UK software provider, thousands of users have accepted terms and conditions where they sell their immortal soul to the software provider for eternity, for a benefit of €5 or something like that, just because they did not read what they were signing. And these are layered documents that make reference to other documents that are only available online. They permanently change. The terms of conditions of big companies, of social networks, are only a snapshot. You will have difficulties to recover what you have signed 2 years ago when you signed up for terms and references. So that is also different. You do not keep a very clear piece of paper. You just click on yes, and then the whole thing is somewhere lost. I truly believe that we are having a very big problem with the metadata usage, which is also a very strong business proposition of those companies that are providing customized advertising to us and claim that they could not have a business case anymore if they could not do that. So there is a serious issue. I think your legal concerns are mostly covered. But unfortunately, the legal exceptions, either by superseding law or by consent of the individual, are making the whole thing, turning the whole thing upside down. So the practical effects are extremely limited.
Okay, thank you very much. That brings us to the end of this session. I'm going to thank our panelists, Mr. Pranil, Mr. Lechner. I think that was most instructive. And maybe just a final remark is, I've heard a lot this morning about how things are very problematic, very difficult and impossible, and you know, I'm an optimist, and I think it's not the first time in history that we're grappling with technological and ethical challenges posed to us by new technologies, and I'm sure that, you know, we will find solutions and things will become possible, because the technology that is presenting us with these challenges right now was thought impossible only just a few decades ago. So I'm sure we'll figure it out. But thank you very much for your contributions. Then I'm going to invite onto the podium our next panel, and I can announce to you that we're going to skip the presentation of the report of Mr. Moraes and Mr. Kirkhope, because Mr. Kirkhope cannot be here, I understand. So we have a bit more time. However, I am going to be a bit more strict, because we have to start our video link session at 11:30 sharp. So we'll have on the podium with us Mr. Christopher SOGHOIAN. I hope I pronounced that correctly.
Hello.
And hello.
Hi.
Hi. I hope I didn't massacre your name. Mr. SOGHOIAN from the American Civil Liberties Union, principal technologist in Speech, Privacy and Technology Project, and to my left, Mr. Christian HORCHERT, who is an IT security consultant from Germany. So I'm going to ask you to each do a short presentation of really no more than 10 minutes, starting with Mr. SOGHOIAN.
Sure.
Yes, you have the floor.
Members of the LIBE committee, thank you for the invitation to testify before you today, and thank you for seeking out the advice of technical experts. In my testimony before you today, I'll make two main points. First, the mobile phone networks in Europe are not safe. They're not safe from American intelligence agencies, from the Russians, the Chinese, and other governments too. Second, that European policymakers and regulators have had ample warning about serious security flaws that expose European citizens' communications to interception. Sadly, these warnings have often been ignored or worse, instead of fixing the flaws, they have been exploited by European law enforcement and intelligence agencies. In October of this year, the topic of mobile phone privacy instantly became an issue of significant political concern after journalists writing for Der Spiegel revealed that the U.S. National Security Agency had for years monitored the telephone calls of German Chancellor Angela Merkel. Subsequent reporting also revealed that the phone spying was conducted by a joint NSA-CIA unit, which operates out of 80 U.S. embassies and consulates around the world. Ordinarily, it should not matter that mobile phone signals can be intercepted as they pass through the air. The security of the mobile phone mobile telephone network should not depend upon the difficulty of recording the signals, but rather there should be other security technologies in use that protect our calls. For example, we all regularly use open Wi-Fi networks at coffee shops and hotels to conduct sensitive tasks, such as sending emails and doing online banking. Although these Wi-Fi networks are not secure, the internet services we use over the Wi-Fi networks are themselves secure. For example, the lock icon that you see in your web browser when you connect to your bank's website, to Google, or to Facebook is an indication that your interactions with those sites are secure, even if the Wi-Fi network you are using is not. Sadly, there is no lock icon built into our mobile phones. The security that is built into mobile networks is decades old, very weak, and in fact, quite thoroughly broken. As such, there is little protecting our calls, your calls, from the NSA or, in fact, any other government. The security vulnerabilities in GSM mobile telephone networks exploited by the NSA have been known in Europe for nearly two decades. For example, Rohde & Schwarz, a German company, is generally believed in 1997 to have created the first commercial device capable of intercepting mobile telephone calls. Several other European companies, including firms in Germany, Switzerland, and the United Kingdom, manufacture and sell similar surveillance products that are capable of exploiting long-standing security flaws in mobile telephone networks to intercept calls and monitor nearby phones. The customers of these European surveillance companies include law enforcement and intelligence agencies in several European countries. Although this technology is generally introduced and used in secret, in Germany it has been used and regulated in a relatively transparent manner. For example, German law regulates the use of this technology by government agencies. It requires statistical reports to be published every year. Moreover, it has been the subject of several formal parliamentary questions, as well as a decision from the German Constitutional Court permitting its use. This, of course, means that your own law enforcement and intelligence agencies have known that telephone networks in your respective countries can be spied on by anyone with the right equipment. They know this because they have purchased and are using this equipment for surveillance. Furthermore, as European companies are manufacturing and then exporting this technology outside of your own borders, it is likely that other government agencies, such as national telecommunications regulators and export permit granting agencies, also know about the long-standing telephone network security flaws and the technologies that can exploit them. Now, it would be one thing if this technology were only manufactured by European companies and sold to European governments. However, that is not the case. Companies in the United States, in China, Russia, India, and Israel sell similar telephone spying technology to their own governments and to other governments around the world as part of the $5 billion global market for commercial surveillance technology. Mobile telephone interception devices are reportedly among the, quote, best-selling items exhibited at surveillance industry trade shows. Indeed, a few weeks after it was revealed that the United States was spying on the telephone calls of Chancellor Merkel, media reports revealed that China, Russia, the United Kingdom, and even North Korea were also intercepting her calls, too. Even if the American government keeps its promise to stop spying on the calls of Chancellor Merkel, no amount of political pressure will stop these and other governments from using their spying equipment, too. If telephone calls can be intercepted, they will be intercepted by those governments capable of doing so. What this means is that if you do not wish for your calls to be intercepted, you must do something about it. During the past few years, prominent security researchers have repeatedly warned about the flaws in mobile telephone networks that these so-called government-grade surveillance devices exploit. Although interception once required a $50,000 device, commercial surveillance device, to intercept calls, it is now possible for researchers, hobbyists, and hackers to build their own interception devices for a few hundred dollars. For example, in 2010, a security researcher intercepted calls from the phones of audience members at the DEF CON security conference in Las Vegas. Mobile telephone interception technology has been democratized. In spite of the repeated warnings by researchers, telecommunications regulators in Europe and in my own country, the United States, have ignored the security problems. Likewise, the major telephone service providers have neither been forced to improve the security of their networks nor warn their customers about the significant risks of interception. As you continue your inquiry, I strongly encourage you to look into the widespread failure of European telecommunications regulators to protect your telephone networks against the threat of interception by governments using technologies that are now widely available. It should not have taken the leaks by Edward Snowden to get policymakers to start thinking about the security of your telephone networks. If you do not wish for Americans, the Russians, the Chinese, or any foreign government to spy on the phone calls of your policymakers, business leaders, and journalists, you must take action. However, protecting your telephone networks from such surveillance threats will also require the large-scale deployment of advanced encryption technologies that will thwart your own law enforcement and intelligence agencies' use of the same interception technology. There are systems that are secure against all threats or systems that are secure against no threats, and right now you have systems that are secure against nothing. Your senior political leaders likely already have government-issued encrypted telephones, although I suspect few, if any, members of this committee have them. These devices are usually quite expensive, although communication security does not have to be a luxury. In fact, freely available open-source encrypted voice communication software apps already exist today, which anyone can download and use. The real question is whether you are ready to promote, or better, to provide all of your citizens with the same degree of communications confidentiality and thus protection from wiretapping by governments foreign and domestic that your own political leaders already enjoy. I strongly urge you to take action to protect the communications of all Europeans through the mass adoption of privacy-enhancing technologies. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Our second speaker, Mr. Horchert, you have 10 minutes.
I'm going to talk in German. Sehr geehrte Frau
Ms. Innetfeldt, ladies and gentlemen, honorable members of the European Parliament, first of all, I'd like to thank you for inviting me here, and I'd like to express my respect here that you have picked up on this issue of monitoring and surveillance and how it affects civil rights. I'm security researcher. I make my living on IT security and on providing advice and developing defense strategies against attacks, and that's how I concentrate on security. The private sphere and the right to private communication in the digital world are difficult to protect than in the analog area, and there are technical reasons for this, and protection of basic rights in the digital world is closely linked with the issues of IT security, and because the lot of technical discussions going on, we don't really know how producers have built in backdoors. We don't know who knows about these and who are exploiting them, who's passing on the information. To counter this lack of certainty and security, we have to bring out the idea of technology into the open to discuss it, and it's only by bringing it out into the open that we can appreciate what the issues are and to deal with them then. Restrictions such as vendor-owner disclosure, where only the producers are allowed to know about what goes on in their products, is not the right way of doing things. Those people who discover problems and insecurity have an obligation to publicize this, and they shouldn't be treated as enemies if they do. And it's just as dangerous to bring in things like the hacker tools ban and other criminal offences, because these hacker tools are exactly the same ones which are needed to test security, to see if security actually works. And to produce that technical security, we have to have more clear rules. Maybe I can just mention a few ideas which I think would be worthwhile entertaining here. First of all, there has to be a general ban, on security services and police obliging people to build in backdoors and security risks in hardware and software, because any opportunity that's open to the secret services can also be exploited by criminal organizations. Civil society doesn't really care if it's organized crime, secret service, or the armies who's attacking them. The defense strategies are always exactly the same. Secondly, there needs to be better liability and guarantee rules for software and hardware. At the moment, there are IT products which are being produced and sold, and the guarantees only last for 2 or 3 years, and sometimes they're deliberately limited, and the guarantees are completely inappropriate. They don't, not really worth what the paper they're written on, because the actual software is used for maybe 10 years. And if you use non-open technology, open source software or open hardware, then it's difficult to get rid of the problems over time. So these technical issues, after they've the guarantees have lapsed, they should be made public. And we have to make sure that people can deal with these technologies throughout the course of the life of these technologies. They can't be changed or tampered with to prevent that. And fourthly, there need to be more sanctions brought in if the producers themselves don't raise the problems in their software or hardware. Fifthly, we have to have better encryption of communication services. There have to be certain algorithms that are used, and the way of checking these have to make sure that there's no possibility to change things ex post in the case of compromise. Sixthly, in protecting the private sphere and technologies used there, there has to be a right to anonymous communication, just as there is in the analog world. And there needs to be anonymous, or at least pseudonymous, financial transactions possible. And so in looking at the technology, we have to redefine how we do this, how we support things, for example, through companies or universities. But above all, there needs to be a fundamental understanding, and more importantly, a willingness to genuinely change something here. To conclude, I would say that the reliability of technology needs to be improved, and that's an urgent issue. Also, a basic objective should be to make technical insecurity, that's why a fundamental goal should be to make technical insecurity much more expensive than technical security. At the moment, it's the reversal of that situation. There's too little incentives and obligations to develop things for the end customer.
Okay, that brings us to the question and answer session. We'll start with the rapporteur in the shadows, Mr. MORAES.
Thank you very much, and thank you to both of you. To Dr. SOGHOIAN, thank you also for your evidence in Washington and for the work the ACLU is doing. And in relation to that, I wanted to ask you in particular if the ACLU has done a technical analysis or an analysis of the federal court judgment of the telephone data or metadata that was collected. Now, we had a congressional delegation led by Mike Rogers this week, and we had a very dismissive analysis of how effective that federal court judgment has been. But the reporting of it on the BBC and other outlets has suggested it's a significant judgment. Now, there's a six-month appeal on this judgment, but some of the reporting, including on the BBC, has suggested that it could take effect immediately. Now, my question to you is, has the ACLU done an analysis of the judgment? And if it hasn't, are you going to do an analysis? Because we're also going to be talking to Glenn Greenwald later. Edward Snowden issued a statement via him and others indicating a welcoming of this judgment. Now, the reason I'm asking you this question is because the ACLU would be the key NGO that would analyze such a judgment, and we are quite interested to know that now that this is in the federal system, it's one of the key judgments being issued. There's a technical aspect to this. It's talking about telephone data, metadata. Exactly how significant is it? Is it going to lead to other judgments? How far is it going to go? And it's important to us in the European Union to know exactly how much this will affect the domestic audience in the United States, given the reaction we had from this congressional delegation. My other question is the issue about the degree of cooperation between IT companies and internet providers. We've had a lot of evidence from Facebook and all the other companies. You may have seen previous evidence that was given, and it was just to ask for a snapshot of your view of the evidence that you will have seen, because I know you're following the inquiry. I don't want a long statement, but just your thoughts on what Microsoft, Facebook, and the others were saying to us from an ACLU point of view. Thank you.
Thank you. Even if we have time, I'm going to ask colleagues. I mean, you get a different treatment because you're the rapporteur, but I'm going to ask colleagues to be a bit more concise, and also the panelists, so that we don't run out of time. Of course, you're privileged. Okay. Mr. SOGHOIAN, you want to reply first?
I'll try and be as brief as possible. So I should be clear, I'm not a lawyer. I'm a computer scientist, and I'm embedded within a team of lawyers who do all of our litigation. We obviously disagree with Chairman Rogers. He's the chairman of the Intelligence Committee, and he's been a consistent defender of the surveillance program. We are suing the government to end the surveillance program, so we obviously have a pretty significant disagreement at the policy level. This case, the decision that came down this week, is the first time that a judge on any court other than the secretive FISA court has actually analyzed this program, and for that reason alone, it is a pretty significant step. We have brought our own case. Other civil liberties groups, such as the Electronic Frontier Foundation, have also brought their own cases against the U.S. government, and so there are several federal cases running in parallel, all focused on this program. This really was the first case, the first decision by a judge, but we expect there to be others. The most significant aspect of this decision is that the judge sort of really tears apart the concept of people not having any reasonable expectation of privacy into their metadata, and in particular to the idea that if the government can collect metadata about one person, then it's okay for the government to get metadata about 300 million people who've done nothing wrong. So that's been interesting to see. This will not go into effect today or tomorrow. The judge has issued his opinion but stayed its enforcement until an appeal is processed. He has given the government fair warning, though, that once the appeal is decided, if it goes in the direction of privacy, that he expects the government to shut down the surveillance of the plaintiffs in that case straight away, and doesn't want any stonewalling by the government, saying that it would take a lot of time to actually remove their data from the database. So it's good news, and it's, if you haven't read the decision, although most judicial decisions are not particularly interesting, this one really is packed with some fun things. So it makes for pleasant reading if you're at all interested in surveillance. On the question of cooperation between tech companies, internet companies, and the US government, I actually published an op-ed yesterday in the MIT Technology Review talking about how the Snowden disclosures had forced the technology companies to increase their security. I think it's important to note that the U.S. government will get data many ways. They will get it through their partnerships with international telecommunications companies, the companies that operate undersea fiber optic cables. They will get it through their partnerships with tech companies, and if they cannot get it in those ways, then they will hack into systems and steal it. They haven't really needed to go to Microsoft or to Facebook or to Yahoo and demand data at scale because they could get it at the network level. Because these companies didn't encrypt their customers' information as it was transmitted over the internet, because they woefully were not securing their customers' data with the most basic of security technologies, the NSA could hoover it up, could collect it at scale at the points where it was transiting the internet. In the wake of the Snowden disclosures and in the wake of front page news stories about this, Microsoft and Yahoo and several other companies have announced that they will be upgrading their security. And so I would expect that their relationship with the NSA will change, because now the U.S. government will have to go to them to get data that they didn't need to before. But it, you know, you should remember that all of these companies have teams of people who are employed by them who do nothing but respond to surveillance requests. They know that they get requests by the U.S. government and by other governments, and they're comfortable with this as long as they don't get too many of them, and as long as each request isn't for too many people's information at once. Ultimately, many of these companies have embraced business models of advertising-supported services that give them an incentive to collect as much data about their customers as possible, which then means that the government, my government or other governments, can show up after the fact and demand this information. So there's not so much a conspiracy between the tech companies and the U.S. government to collect the data, and it's more a symbiotic relationship. The tech companies collect the data for their own advertising purposes, and then the government can show up later and ask for it.
Thank you. Mr. Horchert, you want to come in? No? Okay. Mr. Vos signaled that he doesn't want to ask a question, so then I put on my other hat again as a shadow rapporteur on behalf of ALDE. I have two short questions. First question to both of you. It's a bit, you know, if you're being the devil's advocate, and I asked the question in the previous round, you spoke of the right to anonymous communication and even the right to anonymous financial transactions. And as a normal, innocent citizen, I agree with you that we should have that right, and that we should be protected. However, there are criminals in this world. There are bad people. So how do we protect the good people but make sure that law enforcement authorities have access to information about bad people? Second question to Mr. SOGHOIAN in particular. We heard from Mr. Rogers yesterday, the delegation from U.S. Congress, the statement, there has been no mass surveillance. How do you qualify that statement? So Mr. Horchert first, and then Mr. SOGHOIAN.
Also die Frage nach...
Now, what can we do against criminals? Well, good old police work is the answer to that. And we carry out investigations and inquiries in the usual way. That's the way to proceed. Now, if we look at the context, we need to try to minimize the possibilities of problems arising, nip things in the bud. Sometimes you have people who wish to, who use vulnerabilities for Bitcoin mining, for other kinds of attacks, for data mining, for whatever. I think the idea is to try to restrict as much as possible the possibility of crimes happening in the first place. If prosecution comes after the event, we need measures to allow prosecution. And I think making things unsafe deliberately is a completely wrong-headed approach, as far as I'm concerned. It's difficult for me to answer this question. We've got to rethink things throughout the world and change the mentality. I don't know if that is good enough by way of reply.
So you will have undoubtedly been told that your countries are facing a grave cyber threat, that criminals and foreign governments are hacking into your systems and stealing sensitive intellectual property, stealing the data of your citizens. And that's probably true to a certain extent. But the problem is there's no way to design a system that is secure against the finest of state, nation-state hackers that your local police can also get into. You have to pick one or the other. Now, you have built networks and systems that have been designed for interception. Your national internet systems and your national internet networks and your national telephone networks have been built with surveillance in mind. Every single one of you live in a country where the telephone networks have purchased equipment required by law that have surveillance features built into them. Your global internet connections have surveillance features built into them. You shouldn't be surprised when, you know, someone else shows up and hacks into the system and enables the interception feature, which is exactly what happened to Greece in 2004 when an unknown entity broke into their network, enabled the wiretapping feature, and spied on the Greek prime minister and members of his cabinet. You have built networks that are insecure by design, and this is not an accident. This is the intentional, this is the goal. And the reason is because your law enforcement and security services, their interests have come first. The question is, what are you more worried about? Are you worried about the threat of the U.S. government and other governments spying on you? Are you worried about hackers and criminals stealing your information? Are you worried about the paparazzi listening to your telephone calls and stealing your information? Or do you want to live in a world where the police can easily get the data that they want? But you cannot have both. You have to pick one or the other. And I don't think that political leaders have quite woken up to this realization. I think many people think that they can have their cake and eat it too, that they can have European-made encryption technologies that will allow law enforcement access and keep Chinese hackers out. The NSA has the best hackers money can buy. And so, if the police can get in, they'll hack into the police and use the police's credentials to get the data. If you want secure systems, you have to put security first, but that means giving up some forms of law enforcement access that traditionally would have been available. Now, that doesn't mean that law enforcement go dark completely, but it does mean that certain avenues of investigation and certain tools are going to slip into the history books. But, you know, you cannot hide metadata easily, and there's no way to hide location information. And this is information that was never available in decades past. There is now this wealth of location information that exists, revealing everywhere we go, and there is no way to hide location data. The laws of physics do not let you have a working telephone and have your location data not be available. So the police win some and they lose some, but right now you've built systems that are terribly insecure and you're suffering the consequences of it. To your question about Chairman Rogers' statement that there is no mass surveillance program, you know, clearly they're playing word games. They don't believe that a metadata program is surveillance. We respectfully disagree. I think we all know that the collection of information about 300 million innocent people in my country and countless hundreds of millions of people abroad, that is surveillance. Whether or not they look at it all the time, whether or not it contains the content of communications or metadata. Metadata is among the most sensitive information because it reveals intimate and private things. You know, your trip to an abortion clinic, your trip to a protest, that is captured in metadata. And so it's, of course, ridiculous to believe that this isn't surveillance.
Thank you. Mr. Albrecht for the Greens.
First of all, thank you to be here and to testify. I think those were very clear remarks. I mean, I also would like to ask about the interpretations which are out there that it's not like the media rights. That was something we heard yesterday. It's all different to what the media writes on these surveillance issues. So my question to you would be really, I mean, do you think that people are, or politicians are aware of what's actually going on and what's possible with the analysis of those personal data, metadata, and what would be your specific recommendations that we should draw the attention to in our conclusions here in the inquiry when it comes to security and to privacy protection and to the technical means which you are describing? Thanks.
Thank you. Mr. Horchert first.
I believe that most politicians, most people that deal with this kind of thing, really understand what this means. People who don't have a creative approach to things don't have a full understanding of what's happening. There are problems of implementation, of course. You hear about some of these issues, and they say, yes, that's a good idea. We want that kind of thing, but then they ignore the potential problems. There's no middle way. That's the problem. And you've got to be clear about that. We always come back to the same point. You can't have one and the other at the same time. You can't have your cake and eat it. You've got to plump for legislative measures instead of worrying about potential shortcomings. So you need to take clear choices. We need these creative approach and have a clear understanding of what the implications are. I forgot what the second question was. Yes. I made a couple of points about this. So you can see things as a product, but they are somewhat different from your other kinds of products. The way we look at software and hardware today is somewhat different. I mean, nobody's going to buy a car if it doesn't have any wheels. But somehow we take a similar approach with software. We buy software that's no good. We want an improvement on it. And a lot of what happens it is down to software, and then you've got the backdoors, which are there already. So for me, it's clear that there is a choice to be operated here. You've got to decide. Either you want a technological society that has the possibility of security, or just say, well, never mind. Basically, those are the two options.
Okay, Mr. Sogoyan.
So to the first question of are politicians aware of what's going on, I think the answer is probably no. You're starting to become aware, and this is in no way meant to disrespect politicians, but generally, there people who go into politics have a background in political science or the law. I mean, there are, some exceptions, obviously, but many people in this room probably spent their university studies studying political science and not computer science. And so, surveillance is really high tech. It's very complex. And, even in my own country, the committees that are analyzing these issues, they don't have any technical people working for them. The FISA court, which is issuing these very creative opinions permitting surveillance, they don't have any technical experts working for them. And so there's, in fact, been, this process that we've learned where the NSA has for years done things that the FISA court thought they weren't doing. There was a mismatch between the FISA court's understanding of what was happening and what was actually happening on the ground. And in many ways, that was because the information wasn't being communicated clearly by the Department of Justice and NSA, but also because the FISA court didn't know which questions to ask. I think it's difficult for lawyers and political scientists to perform effective oversight of highly complex technical surveillance programs when they don't have many or any technical experts working for them. And so in the longer term, I think, you need to think about how you equip yourselves with technical expertise. If your voters are not going to start voting in computer scientists, then you need to start hiring them at the committee level and MEP staff assistant level. To your second question of what should you be doing, as I suggested in my opening comments, I really feel like a lot of this comes down to a total regulatory failure. So the Europeans have what is probably the most robust system of data protection oversight of any set of countries. You have very powerful data protection regulators in some cases. and a willingness to regulate the telecommunications carriers. The massive reduction in roaming fees, for example, in Europe shows that your regulators are willing to crack the whip against the wireless carriers on issues that they believe to be important. The question is, why have your telecommunications and privacy regulators not cracked the whip? Why have they not pushed this issue of data security for cell phone networks? Similarly, you know, in the last 2 or 3 years, Google, Facebook, Twitter, Microsoft have all finally upgraded their security to make passive interception at the network difficult, if not impossible. But this has largely been as a result of pressure by U.S. government regulators, by civil society actors in the U.K., in the U.S., and in other European countries. Where have European regulators been on the issue of HTTPS transport security? The lock icon in your browser, where has the pressure from European regulators been? You know, the issue of cookies in Europe has been a major topic. The issue of Google Wi-Fi has been a major topic. And I think if European data protection regulators had spent as much time worrying about the lack of strong encryption in cell phone networks as they have done over cookies, I think you would find yourself in a very different situation vis-a-vis NSA surveillance of your telephone calls.
Thank you very much. It would be interesting to know if the situation would have been any different if data protection were still in the Department of the Internal Market rather than Justice and Home Affairs as it is now. I have two more speakers, Mr. Engström and Mr. Mulder, and then we'll wrap it up. Mr. Engström.
Thank you. Again, thank you for very interesting and very, very good presentations. And yeah, this is quite obviously quite a big problem. To Mr. Segoyan on the telephone thing, you talked about the encryption being completely broken since 2 decades. We have GSM and we got 4G. Is it the same problem, or is 4G in any way better, or does it apply to everything? And then you talked about that, and you talked about the lawful intercept capabilities that are part of it. Am I right in thinking that these are two separate vulnerabilities? And if so, which one is the more serious one? And to Mr. Horchert, continuing on Ms. Intveld's playing the devil's advocate, when it comes to anonymous communication, I would say that's politically doable. We got to Article 8 in the European Convention, the right to private communication. So okay, that's probably doable. When you talk about the need for anonymous payments, that will, if anybody puts forward a proposal like that, other people will say, okay, that's going to facilitate money laundering on a massive scale. Now, how would you respond to that person? How would you respond to that counter-argument?
Okay, last question, Mr. Mulder.
Thank you. I equally find it an extremely fascinating discussion, and to continue the analogy with the house that you lock and so on, you will never have a system that is completely safe whatever you do in a house or in a safe. There will always be somebody who is able to be more clever than the protection. But if you have a reasonably protected house, is it possible for an individual to buy the technology today on my phone or on my laptop or whatever it is to have it reasonably protected? You have the commercial companies that sell it to you. And apparently that's not sufficient, but is it possible that it will be the case in the future? Or secondly, is it only a case of the regulators, European or national, that can assure that protection?
Question. Mr. Horchert first.
First of all, on the thing about the houses, well, the problems with analogies is that they are just that, analogies. A house is a house, and software is software. So they're not really comparable, to be fair. The problem is, in the physical world, there are massive differences to the digital world. So you can't really compare them. You can't have a little bit of security. You know, it's not a question that there's a threshold that needs to be crossed by a hacker, because in the end of the day, it doesn't really matter. And the choice between attacks which would be possible for anybody or attacks that would only be possible for those who are better trained, you know, when it comes down to it, it makes no difference. And it comes down to the understanding of a technically secure system that indicates there's a high threshold and that you couldn't just tamper around and manage to get in. A lock on a house, however, is something that you don't need a lot of effort and investment to break into. You know, software in a sandbox that's assigned and that sort of thing is a completely different scenario. It's a different level and it's completely incomparable with the house. On the money, well, yes, we've got the same problem as when it comes to IT security. If every expense that you pay out, you get the profile of a person, what illnesses they're suffering from, who they deal with, where they spend time, etc., etc. So that level of anonymous financial transactions needs to be dealt with differently. It's not just whose name is on the receipt or on the invoice, you know, and where this information is made available on a prescription, for example, there's a problem. So decisions need to be taken. I understand there's a problem with the laundering of money. Now, I'm not an expert there. I have to make no bones about that. But on this, it's a question of taking a decision. It's taking a decision to decide you've got either or. Either you want to protect citizens and society against data being collected over 10, 20 years that is then going to be used against them, or, well, that's basically the only possibility to try and get a clear policy on that particular point.
Thank you, Mr. Soghoian.
So the first few questions from Mr. Engstrom, you asked first whether this was an issue that affected older phones or whether the 3G and 4G networks were more secure. I'm not going to bore you with the intimate details, the intimate technical details, but what I will say is that the security of the 2G networks are 30 years old. And the problem is that the latest and greatest cell phone that you can buy in the stores today, the latest iPhone or latest Android phone, although it will use 3G and 4G when available, will still include the feature, the capability of 2G, so that in case you go and visit a rural place or you visit a foreign country where only 2G is available, it will work. And so one of the techniques that foreign governments use, or the governments use when doing interception, is they jam 3G and 4G, and then they offer their own 2G network that is their own, and then that forces your phone to connect. That is one of the problems. There is better encryption in 3G and 4G, but the carriers must use it. They must choose to use it. Just in the last couple of weeks, T-Mobile in Germany revealed that they were moving their entire network to the latest generation of cell phone encryption for voice communications. But this encryption technology was actually created in 2002. And so it's taken a little while for it to see mass adoption. I mean, 11 years for it to see mass adoption. The cell phone networks move really, really slowly. And so long after cellular encryption technologies have been broken, consumers still continue to use them because the networks continue to keep them deployed. Your second question was whether the vulnerabilities I described in the law enforcement interception features in networks was the same as the one of mobile phone tapping that I described in my opening remarks. No, they're separate issues. To be able to exploit the law enforcement surveillance interfaces built into the networks, you have to have access to the inside of the networks, to the core of the networks. Obviously, you can do that if you are a government or if you are the government in that country or if you employ sophisticated attackers, which many governments do. So that doesn't actually create a practical barrier. On the other hand, the mobile phone, telephone vulnerabilities that I described in my 10-minute opening remarks, those can be exploited by everyone right now. Anyone who's within, you know, a mile or two of you can listen to your calls if they have the right equipment and have the desire to do so. And so this isn't just an issue of governments. This is something that the paparazzi can do. This is something that companies can do against their competitors. In India, there has been widespread importation, illegal importation and use of cell phone interception equipment that has led to a dystopian future where anyone's phone calls can be intercepted by anyone else. And you see the phone calls of members of parliament in India being leaked to the press, of billionaires talking on the phones to their lovers also being leaked to the press. I mean, it's truly chaotic, and people there have totally given up any faith in the security of the phone networks. The next question was this idea of, you know, can a house be kept completely safe? Well, to go with your analogy, no one's even tried to put a lock on the door right now. The house, the door has been open for years, and the only thing stopping people from listening to our calls has been that no one was trying, or in fact, the people who were doing it weren't talking about it. This isn't a question of whether we have, you know, next generation cutting edge security or sort of okay security. For years, you've had no security at all. And so let's get to a point where we have reasonable security, and then we can talk about whether it's good enough. But right now, you have nothing. Was there a second question after that? I think that was everything. Sorry.
Is that a question of regulators, or is that a question of an individual?
So there exist tools right now that anyone can download that let them make secure encrypted telephone calls. The problem is, as the expression goes, it takes two to tango. And so both parties of the call need to use the same tools. There are apps that I have on my phone right now that I use to make encrypted calls, but the number of people who know about them and who've downloaded them is very small. So I'm professionally very paranoid, and many of my colleagues are very paranoid, so we can have, you know, encrypted telephone calls, and I can send encrypted text messages to my girlfriend, but that's about it. If we want to see the mass adoption, and if we want these to be the default, tomorrow, if you buy a cell phone, if you want it to come pre-installed with encrypted voice, encrypted text, encrypted email, either you need a market solution, you need companies to offer this, but given the lack of competition in most cellular markets, that's probably not going to happen. Or you need regulators demanding it. And so if your national regulators tomorrow said it is not possible, it is not going to be allowed to sell a cell phone that does not include encrypted voice enabled by default, then that solves the problem. But right now, it requires action on the part of users, and we know that anything that requires action will actually mean that it will not be widely deployed.
Thank you very much. Colleagues, I thank the panelists for their interventions and answering our questions. I think we've had a very useful session this morning, and I at least take away from it that there is, at the regulatory level, at legislative level, there is a lot to be done. There is also a lot that Europe needs to do in terms of investing in security that we have basically not yet adapted to this new reality that we're living in. And there are a lot of other conclusions to be drawn as well, which will be, which will end up in the report of Mr. Moraes. Colleagues, it's 11:15. Our interactive session starts in 15 minutes, so I propose that we suspend for 15 minutes and then we come back here at 11:30 for our interactive session with Mr. Greenwald.
Hello in Rio, can you hear me?
Now you're on. Yes, I can hear you.
Perfect, thank you. We're going to start in a few minutes.
My name's not Rio. Can you tell him my name isn't Rio?
Hello? We don't seem to have a connection. Can you hear me?
Hi, how are you?
Hello, we hear each other now. Good. Mr. Greenwald, very welcome to the session of the Committee of Inquiry of the European Parliament. We have about an hour for this session, and I'm first going to invite you to do your presentation, and then afterwards we'll take questions and answers. So very pleased to have you with us here today. I'll give you the floor, or the video link rather. The floor is yours.
Great, good afternoon, and thank you to the committee for convening this inquiry and for inviting me to speak to you as well. There has been a virtual avalanche of stories and reports over the last 6 months regarding espionage and electronic surveillance by the NSA and its partners, and each of these stories has been extremely important, but I think that the quantity of them has sometimes endangered the ultimate point from being obscured. And so I just wanted to spend a little bit of time discussing what I think is the primary revelation, the crux of all of these stories that ties them together, and that I think is the most important thing for us to realize. And that is what the ultimate goal of the NSA is, along with its most loyal, one might say subservient junior partner, the British agency GCHQ, when it comes to the reason why the system of suspicionless surveillance is being built. And the objective of this system is nothing less than the elimination of individual privacy worldwide. And at first glance, that might seem like it's a bit hyperbolic, like it's a little bit melodramatic, but it isn't. It's a literal description of what the NSA and its closest surveillance partners are attempting to achieve. And the reason that I know that that's what they're attempting to achieve is because this is what they say over and over and over again. On occasion, they say it publicly, and repeatedly they say it in their private documents, which were written when they thought nobody was able to hear what it was that they were saying. There are instances where Keith Alexander, the general who is the chief of the NSA, has made comments along the lines of the objective of the NSA is to collect all signals intelligence, all forms of electronic communication by and between human beings. And when this was first reported in The Guardian and elsewhere, the NSA tried to dismiss it as sort of a literary allusion or even a joke. It's no joke. Throughout the NSA documents, there appears continuously all sorts of references to the fact that the goal of the NSA is captured by the phrase collect it all. Whenever the U.S. and its four closest surveillance partners meet each year at a signals development conference, the four closest surveillance partners being the U.K., Canada, Australia, and New Zealand, there are constant inclusions of slogans like collect it all or know it all or exploit it all throughout all of these documents. This is actually the mission of the NSA. And one of the ways that you see this mission manifest is that there are numerous programs that the NSA develops and pursues that have no real purpose other than to identify the few pockets of communication that still exist on the planet that the NSA hasn't yet quite successfully invaded. And the NSA is obsessed institutionally with the idea that there are still places and methods that exist that are impervious to their invasion, and they work every day to try and rectify what they see as this problem. The problem being that there are still places on the planet that human communication can take place without their collecting, storing, monitoring, and analyzing that communication. So there are documents devoted, for example, to trying to understand how better to invade the Wi-Fi systems on airplanes based on the concern that human beings can still go on airplanes and use the internet or mobile phones for a few hours in their lives and not be susceptible to their surveillance net. There are documents that discuss ways to circumvent advanced encryption tools out of fear that individuals will develop the means to be able to communicate with one another privately without the NSA being able to invade those communications. And so what we're really faced with is not just the creation of the most pervasive system of suspicionless surveillance ever built in human history, although we certainly are faced with that. But it is beyond that. It is an institution that has embedded into its mandate
the mission to ensure that human beings can no longer communicate with one another electronically with any degree of privacy. Simply in through institutional inertia, there is an effort to collect everything. And over the past 6 months, I've done a lot of reporting in many different countries about espionage targeted at many different populations. And everywhere I do this reporting, I do interviews with newspapers or television programs in those countries. And I am always asked, why interest in Sweden? Why are they so interested in what people who are Swedes are discussing? Or why is the NSA obsessed with collecting all of the communications of Brazilians or any number of other countries? And the answer I always give is the answer that comes directly from the NSA's document, which is that the NSA and its Five Eyes partners don't need any specific reason to collect anybody's communications. Just the fact that human beings are communicating with one another is reason enough for the NSA to decide that it should be collected and stored and monitored. They don't need specific rationale. Their only rationale is that nobody should be able to communicate without the NSA's being able to invade the communication. And every one of the stories that we've done, every one of the specific stories, is driven by this overarching theme. And that's why I think it's fair to say that the significance of this reporting and of what Mr. Snowden revealed to the world really can't be overstated. If governments are devoted to the elimination of privacy worldwide, as the U.S., the U.K., and its three partners are clearly devoted to doing, that has profound consequences for everybody who communicates electronically, which is most people on the planet. And at the very least, it's something that we ought to be discussing and debating openly, if not figuring out how to stop. The second point I wanted to make is I wanted to discuss a little bit what some of the reaction has been to our reporting, especially in Europe, but also around the world, because I think it reveals a very important point. It was back in late June, so 5 months ago or so, that Der Spiegel first reported that the NSA was targeting ordinary Germans by the hundreds of millions for collection of the metadata of their telephone records. And the reaction of the German government was very muted. There were some symbolic gestures to objecting, but by and large, it was very restrained, the reaction. There wasn't very much of an effort to really do anything about it. And it really wasn't until Der Spiegel was able to reveal that not only ordinary Germans, but even the German Chancellor, Angela Merkel, was the target of the surveillance system, did the German government finally react with genuine indignation and decided that it needed to do something about it. And I think that's a pattern that has repeated itself in other countries as well, sort of apathy and indifference when it's revealed that the population is being targeted with mass surveillance, but true anger when governments find out that they themselves are targeted. And I think part of what explains that interesting dichotomy is the fact that political officials often tend to be concerned about their own interest and not the interests of the citizens whom they're ostensibly representing. But I think the broader point has been this idea that as long as the NSA is quote unquote only collecting, then we can live with that level of intrusion. But when it comes to listening to people's cell phone calls or reading their emails, that's when genuine outrage is warranted. And I just want to spend a moment addressing this point, because I think it's probably the single greatest misconception in the reporting that we've been doing. If you talk to surveillance experts, as I know that you're doing, what you will hear, I think almost by consensus at this point around the world, is that metadata is not simply almost as invasive as content interception, or even as invasive. In most cases, in most meaningful senses, collection of metadata is now more invasive than collection of content. And it isn't just surveillance experts who think that way, it's the NSA itself. Throughout these documents appears the recognition that collecting metadata is the supreme priority of the agency, not because it protects people's privacy, but precisely because it enables the NSA to invade people's privacy more effectively than the interception of content. And I think sometimes it's difficult to understand that in the abstract, but it's easy to understand it when concrete examples are used. And so if you can imagine, for example, a woman who decides that she wants to get an abortion, if you're listening in on her phone call, what you will hear is her calling a clinic. The clinic will answer with a generic sounding name, like Eastside Clinic or something like that. You will hear the woman who you've decided to target for surveillance ask for an appointment Tuesday at 2 o'clock, get an appointment Tuesday at 2 o'clock, and then hang up the phone, and you'll have no idea why she called or even what kind of clinic she called or what the purpose was. But if you're collecting her metadata, you will see the phone number that she called. You will then be able to identify it as an abortion clinic. You will know how many times she called that clinic, and you will have exactly the information that you wouldn't get if you were simply listening to her phone call. The same with somebody who has HIV and calls a doctor specializing in HIV once every 3 months, as HIV patients often do. If you're listening to their phone calls, you'll have no idea what kind of doctor they're calling, but if you're collecting their metadata, you'll know everything about their medical condition. The same with somebody who calls a suicide hotline or a drug addiction clinic, or somebody who is speaking with someone who is not their spouse late at night, or any number of other types of intimate activities that human beings engage in that you probably wouldn't be able to apprehend if you're reading their emails or listening to their telephone calls, but that you will instantly be able to understand by collecting their metadata. And then beyond that, there are very sophisticated, increasingly sophisticated tools for analyzing metadata when it's collected in mass, to be able to understand not only who your targets are speaking to, but who those people are speaking to, and then who those people are, and to develop a very comprehensive picture of the network of associations and friends of various individuals, but also of the society generally, to have a very invasive understanding of the private behavior, the private associations, the private thoughts of the people whom you've placed under surveillance by collection of metadata. It really is the case that if you're somebody who values privacy, it would almost be preferable at this point to have the NSA listening to your phone calls and reading your emails than it is for them to collect all of your metadata over the course of many years and be able to link it to everybody else's metadata and then analyze it in secret, virtually no restraints, as the NSA, the GCHQ, and its surveillance partners are doing. The third point I wanted to make and just talk about briefly is the of individual privacy. There's often this sense that I think Western governments have to inculcate people to accept that privacy doesn't really have much value, that it's essentially a luxury, that if you've done nothing wrong, you have nothing to hide, all the sorts of cliches that have been manufactured and then disseminated to get populations accustomed to an invasion of their privacy. And I think that although there's a perception that it's possible, I think in reality it can't work and hasn't worked because human beings instinctively understand why privacy actually is vital. That's why they put passwords on their email accounts and their social media networks. It's why they put locks on their bedroom and bathroom doors. It's why if you propose that you put video cameras in their homes to monitor everything they're doing to protect them from invaders or criminals, they would react with repulsion because human beings instinctively understand that privacy is a critical component of what it means to be a free human being. And I think, though, that it's worth just spending a minute to underscore why that is. And I think we all have this understanding that when we know that we are being watched by other people, when we know that other people are casting a judgmental examination upon our choices and our behavior is much different than when we act in a private realm. When we think other people are watching us, we make choices that conform to orthodoxies, that are designed to avoid behavior deemed to be shameful. Essentially, we make choices to fulfill the expectations that other people in the broader society have of us. We become conformists. We conform to mores and norms. When we have a realm that we can go into where we're confident that we're not being watched, can we test boundaries? Can we engage in creativity and dissent? Can we violate orthodoxies? That is essentially the realm in which human freedom exclusively resides, when we can decide for ourselves what kind of choices we want to make. In a society in which the private realm is abolished, in which human beings know that they're susceptible to being watched at any time, and I think that's the key, not necessarily that every one of their emails is being read, but that their emails and telephone calls can be monitored by unseen agencies, just the knowledge that your behavior is subjected to the possibility of surveillance, is a society that breeds conformity. It's a society in which individuals will have the range of choices that are available to them severely constricted. And it's why every tyranny, every despot, every oppressive government loves a surveillance state, precisely because it eliminates human choice and breeds conformity and really severely reduces the amount of freedom that as individuals we have. And that's why I think that beyond the political implications or the theoretical and legal implications, there are very serious consequences for what it means to be a free individual to live in a state like the one that we're moving to, in which surveillance is both invisible and yet ubiquitous. The final point I wanted to make is that I began by saying that I'm glad that this committee has convened this inquiry and that we're able to have this opportunity to discuss all of these issues. And I just want to remind everybody that there's only one reason why we're able to have the discussion that we're having today and why we have the knowledge and information that we now possess about this system. And that one reason is the brave and quite self-sacrificing decision of my source for this story, Edward Snowden, to risk everything in his life that he had, career stability and personal relationships and the ability to be a free citizen, in order to bring it to all of our attention. And there are governments all over the world, in fact, most governments all over the world, who are extreme beneficiaries of Mr. Snowden's choice. Human beings all over the world consider him a hero. Governments have been able to realize how their privacy is being invaded, to take steps to reform the abuses that we now know about, to convene investigations like the one that we're here to participate in today. All sorts of people, all kinds of governments all over the world exploiting for their own interest and their own benefit the very brave sacrifice that Mr. Snowden made, and I'm glad to see that they're doing that, and I know that he is as well, very gratified that governments are taking so seriously what it is that he has shown them. But what has happened is that although there are lots of governments who have taken advantage of the choice that he made and the sacrifice and bravery that he's shown, there are very, very few governments, in fact, a tiny handful, who are extending a reciprocal courtesy to him of protecting his rights the way that he decided to protect all of ours. And because of that, he currently is in a situation that's very uncertain, where his own government is attempting to subject him to serious persecution, to put him in a cage for decades, if not the rest of his life, for having come forward and shown a light on much of this behavior that is illegal and certainly abusive. And yet most governments around the world have decided to turn their back, not only on him, but on their own obligations ethically and legally to protect people such as Mr. Snowden from persecution by granting them asylum. And I think it's a very strange and disappointing dynamic to watch governments in Europe express indignation over what he has revealed and to take steps to protect themselves against it, while at the same time turning their back on him and allowing his own government to threaten him with life in prison. And I would hope that governments around the world will not only decide to try and exploit his revelations for their own interests, but also to express gratitude for what it is that he did by protecting his basic human rights, which is the right to come forward with evidence of secret wrongdoing on the part of the world's most powerful factions and not be sent to prison for the rest of your life for having done it. So with that, I thank you once again very much for inviting me, and I'm happy to have a discussion with any of you who have questions.
Okay, thank you very much for your introduction. Now we're going to go to questions and answers, and I hope that the connection will remain stable enough. I understand that we can speak our own language, and you will get translation into English, but that our colleagues here do not get any translation, or do you? No. Okay. Okay, but you should get translation into English, so please signal if there's a problem. And I'm also going to ask both colleagues and our guest to be as brief and concise as possible and to allow for a maximum number of questions. So we'll have one question, one answer each time, and I'll ask everybody to really be very, very concise. First of all, we'll listen to the rapporteur, Mr. Claude MORAES of the S&D Group.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Greenwald, for taking the time to be here today. Could I begin where you finished on the source, Edward Snowden? In my report, I'm going to be talking about whistleblower protection. Yesterday, we saw the Congressional Committee led by Mike Rogers, and they rejected the definition of Mr. Snowden as a whistleblower. They said he wasn't a whistleblower. What's your view of that? Because by rejecting that definition, they, of course, are seeing him as a felon. Simple question, what's your view of that? Because it, of course, then leads to a whole set of consequences. Secondly, on the federal court judgment, which you welcomed, again, that Congressional Committee, but also Dianne Feinstein and others have been saying that it's one of many judgments. This is a really important judgment for us and for our report, because it begins to perhaps define for the first time this whole question of metadata, as you have been describing it, as perhaps being significant, that something has happened. Now, you welcome the judgment, but we are now hearing voices saying that this is not significant, the judgment is not significant. Tell us what you think. And finally, the issue about the Guardian reporting that you've been doing, how do you answer critics who say that the reporting is putting people in danger or it's inappropriate? My understanding is that you redacted all sorts of information, but please answer those critics. And finally, we had a European Parliament debate on the issue of David Miranda. If you feel it's appropriate, please comment on the issue of how anti-terrorism powers were used in that instance. Thank you.
Mr. Greenwald?
Great, so I'll just take those in order. I'll just take those in order. I think Mike Rogers picked a very bad week to deny that Mr. Snowden is a whistleblower, given the federal court decision that you reference in the second part of your question, which is that the core program that was the first one that we revealed and that Mr. Snowden, when I first met with him, cited as what caused him to come forward, namely the collection of the metadata of all Americans without regard to suspicion or evidence of wrongdoing, that it violates the core guarantee of the United States Constitution, and the court said it isn't even really close. So somebody who comes forward and reveals a program that a federal court in the United States says violates the Constitution and is therefore illegal is the classic whistleblower. On top of the fact that his revelations have sparked a debate in the United States and around the world, as evidenced by the hearing that we're participating in today, about all sorts of things that I think everybody on all sides of the debate agrees we're better off knowing about. And that is a classic whistleblower, somebody who reveals to the public evidence of wrongdoing, as well as illegality, and that sparks very important debates that no democratic society can be without, and that is exactly what Mr. Snowden has done. It makes him the classic whistleblower. As far as the court opinion that you asked about, what generally happens in the United States when it comes to surveillance is the only courts that ever rule on these programs are courts that no Western democracy would even recognize as courts. They're tribunals that meet in secret and where only one side, namely the U.S. government, is permitted to be present and heard. What happened yesterday is the first time a real court proceeding has actually evaluated the legality of these surveillance programs. And the judge's opinion, which I really urge everybody around the world to read, it's not only about U.S. law, but it's about the way in which these programs destroy the concept of individual privacy and how the rationale offered by the U.S. government is false, namely that it helps terrorism. The judge said there's zero evidence that it has stopped terrorism. This opinion was issued by one of the most respected national security judges in the United States. He's not known as a liberal, quite the opposite. He's a conservative judge appointed by President Bush. And yet what he said is that the national security rationale offered by the government is not only false, but woefully inadequate to justify the very serious privacy infringements that the collection of metadata imposes on everybody who is subjected to it. And given the gravity of the opinion, how vehement it was, and the fact that it was issued by this judge, I think is quite vital. As far as the third question, which is responding to my critics, it's really remarkable because although we have been criticized for disclosing documents which put people in danger, I've actually been pretty vehemently criticized from the other direction as well, which is namely that we have published too few documents, that we've withheld too many, that we've gone too slow in how we publish these documents. And I actually consider that criticism to be vastly more persuasive and valid than the one that says that we put people in danger. Terrorists have long known that the US and the UK governments and lots of other governments are doing everything possible to monitor their communications. Osama bin Laden famously used human couriers to communicate with his associates precisely because all terrorists already know that everything that they're doing on the internet or the telephones is subject to being monitored by various governments. We didn't tell terrorists anything that they didn't already know. What we told people that they didn't already know was that not the terrorists, but that they themselves, innocent people, are the real targets of this mass surveillance system. And we haven't harmed national security or put in danger anyone's lives. The only thing we've harmed is the perception of honesty and the credibility of Western leaders who have built this massive surveillance system in the dark. And then the final point about the case of my partner, David Miranda, the one thing I want to say about that is I hope that everyone understands how extreme and radical the UK government is when it comes to press freedoms. They are literally equating the reporting that we've done not only with espionage, but with terrorism. The US State Department has for years condemned as tyrannical governments that equate journalists with terrorists or journalism with terrorism. And that is exactly what the UK government is doing in this case. And they have lots of other instances where they threaten core press freedoms of The Guardian and of the journalists who have been able to report on this story in a way that I think any country that overlooks what the UK government is doing loses all credibility when it comes to denouncing attacks on press freedom when engaged in by countries that aren't quite as familiar or that are allies of those governments.
Okay, thank you. The next question is by Mr. Axel Voss on behalf of the EPP Group.
And I would like to talk in German. So, vielen Dank, Herr.
Thank you very much, Mr. Greenwald, for giving us your time and giving us an opportunity to put questions to you. I've got basically three small questions. First of all, if there is a serious concern to raise attention to what is going on in our private lives around the world, then I'm wondering at the moment whether we know everything that there is to know, that we ought to know, or whether there might be more information that could catch us by surprise. Obviously, that would be interesting for us as to what more might be lurking out there. Then you mentioned all ways of intercepting communication and how that can be done and is being done. But for a long time now, I think things have been made public which were in the realm of national security and that was in the national realm. So, for example, when you were talking about the opportunities of phoning up an abortion clinic and to be found out. Is that in the interest of the NSA to evaluate that sort of information? The fact that it's possible to do, I think we all understand that. That's not at issue. But is there any interest in the NSA doing that? Thirdly, on the threats we're facing, obviously there are threats in our private sphere. That's what's occupying us at the moment. But what about the threats that exist, as it were, around the globe, threats to states and from states, fundamentalist movements? Do you think it's justified to carry out certain reconnaissance work or activities, even if that may involve delving into information that perhaps should remain private.
Yeah, thank you for those questions. As far as we know, whether we know everything, we certainly know the gist of what these documents reveal, as I began by describing, that the NSA, the GCHQ, and allied governments are attempting to collect all forms of human electronic communication. There are still stories left that we are going to report that are significant. The documents are complicated, and as responsible journalists, it takes us a little bit of time to process them and report them accurately. So we're doing it as fast as we can, consistent with being responsible and accurate. So there definitely are still stories that remain that I think are significant, but certainly after 6 months, I think everybody gets the fundamental point that drove Mr. Snowden to come forward, which is the menace posed by the surveillance system to everybody's individual privacy. As far as the question about the NSA and whether it has an interest in, for example, collecting information about a woman getting an abortion or about people calling drug and alcohol clinics, I think to answer that question, all you have to do is look at recent history, not only in the United States, but in other countries as well. There is no instance where governments have developed the power to engage in secret, massive surveillance where it wasn't abused. For decades in the United States government used its surveillance authorities to monitor and eavesdrop on political dissidents and opponents of the government. The FBI famously tried to get evidence that Martin Luther King was having adulterous affairs and then threatened him or even tried to encourage him to commit suicide. There were decades of abuses that come from this system. I think it's widely understood that if human beings can exercise massive surveillance power in the dark with no accountability or transparency, that it's not likely but inevitable that it will be abused. And just 3 weeks ago, we reported that one of the things the NSA is doing is monitoring people, not who are engaged in terrorist activities or are members of terrorist organizations, but who express what the U.S. government calls radical ideas, who have been targeted by the NSA, and the NSA is collecting information about their visits to pornographic sites or sexual chats that they have online with people who they're not married to. And the document we published contains plans to use that information to publicly humiliate and discredit those people to prevent them from effectively communicating their ideas to the world, a pure instance of abuse. So it may be true that the ordinary person who never challenges the government isn't going to be threatened with that kind of abuse because they're not challenging the government, but I don't think we want to create a society that says you won't be targeted with abusive surveillance as long as you just stay at home and mind your own business and never challenge the government. I think the measure of a free society is how it treats its dissidents and those who express ideas that deviate from the norm. Finally, on the issue of whether there's justifiable surveillance, I think the answer is, of course, there's justifiable surveillance. Everybody agrees that when there's evidence that somebody is engaged in terrorist organizations or terrorist plots, that their conversations can be legitimately monitored. I think it should happen in a framework of accountability and the involvement of courts to make sure that it's not being abused. But that's not what this evidence and the documents show. The documents show whole populations being subjected to mass indiscriminate surveillance. And if you look at some of the specific cases that we've reported on, such as the targeting by the U.S. and the GCHQ of Petrobras, the oil giant, or the Organization of American States, or economic conferences where economic accords are being negotiated in Latin America, or spying on energy companies, such as we've reported in Norway and Sweden, what a lot of this spying is about has nothing to do with terrorism or national security. That is the pretext. It is about diplomatic manipulation and economic advantage and essentially the accumulation of power. Terrorism and national security are the banners that are waved to excuse it, but not the real purpose. These documents leave no doubt about that.
Okay, thank you. I'm afraid I'm going to have to ask you to be a bit more concise in answering, because otherwise we won't make it in the time slot foreseen. I'm now changing hats, and I'm now going to ask a question on behalf of the Liberal Democrat group, My first question would be, amongst all the countless targets that have been revealed, there is one that is of particular interest to the European Parliament, and that is the server of a company called SWIFT, processing bank data. And there are apparently indications in the Snowden papers that say that the US authorities have unauthorized access, or at least created the possibility of having unauthorized access. Do you have any more information on that? Second question, what makes a whistleblower is that he has exhausted all internal procedures for reporting wrongdoing. Is that the case with Mr. Snowden? What happened with the internal procedures? My third question would be, in your introduction, you singled out the UK as an ally of the US. Are there any other particular European countries that you would like to highlight? And my final question is, following on a little bit from the question of Mr. Voss, have you actually seen any evidence or any indications that information has been used against political adversaries, or that it would be allowed to use it, explicitly allowed to use it against political adversaries? Thank you.
As far as the SWIFT banking system is concerned, the New York Times reported 7 years ago that the U.S., the NSA, had targeted the SWIFT banking system. The document that we published in Brazil on the targeting of Petrobras by the NSA and the GCHQ listed as among its targets the SWIFT banking system as well. That's the reporting that we've done so far. So clearly SWIFT is part of the targets of the NSA and the GCHQ. As far as being a whistleblower and exhausting all of the internal procedures, I think Mr. Snowden has explained that in past jobs that he had, when he brought wrongdoing to light, he was dismissed by his supervisors and told to go back to work and mind his own business, the same response that other whistleblowers like Chelsea Manning have received. But I think the most important point there is that there are senators on the Intelligence Committee of the United States who were aware of this wrongdoing and were trying to warn the public about it, but were constrained by law from even telling the public what it is that they had found out and were essentially rendered impotent. And so Mr. Snowden saw that even United States senators, had he gone to them, were barred by law from speaking out about it or doing anything about it, and realized that his only recourse for making this public and getting action was to make it public, that the internal systems for whistleblowers is really a farce. It's an illusion. It's designed to suppress the information and not to bring it to light. As far as other European allies beyond the GCHQ, the UK, obviously the UK is the closest ally. There is another level of cooperation beyond the Five Eyes program, which the U.S. calls the Nine Eyes or Tier B cooperation, where these governments cooperate with the NSA on a case-by-case basis for specific targeting purposes. And Germany and France, Norway, Sweden, and Denmark are among the countries in Europe which participate most extensively with the NSA in these kinds of directed spying opportunity missions, and we publish documents setting that forth. And then finally, as far as the evidence of using this against political adversaries, I described the story that we published in the Huffington Post a couple of weeks ago, in which the NSA plotted to use evidence of sexual activity on the internet in order to discredit and destroy the reputation of people that they consider to be purveyors of ideas they think are radical. There's a lot more reporting that we have to do on that question that I just can't talk about because the documents aren't yet published and the reporting isn't yet done.
Okay, thank you very much. Then the next question will be by Mr. Kirkhope on behalf of the Conservative Group. Sorry, no, inverse order. Mr. Albrecht on behalf of the Green Group and Mr. Kirkhope after the Greens.
Thank you very much. First of all, let me say that I thank you for your work, because I think also without the independent work of journalists scrutinizing and reporting about these documents, we wouldn't have this discussion either. Then let me ask also three questions. First, With regard to the awareness, obviously quite a lot of politicians think that citizens do not care about this. What do you think about this? And is there evidence in your view that this topic and these questions, these fundamental questions, could play a role also in the democratic decision-making process, for example, in elections in the upcoming years? And second question, with regard to spying activities of intelligence services, do you have some hints that there could be also economic interests involved in the spying activities of intelligence services, for example, of the GCHQ towards other EU member states? And so economic spying interest. And the third question is about the work of journalists. As I said, I very much admire the work of independent journalists trying to scrutinize this information, but I heard from many sources, not only from yours, that the work of journalists and free press in Europe is endangered in that extent. And my question would be, in how far you would see possibilities for us politicians to safeguard the work of a free press in Europe and worldwide, and if you consider going to the Strasbourg Human Rights Court on the obvious infringements to the freedom of press in your work. Thank you.
Mr. Greenwald.
Thank you. So first of all, thank you for the kind words. And as far as the question of whether or not citizens care, there's immense anecdotal and also empirical evidence that demonstrates how much they do. I think around the world, literally millions of people have been engaged by this reporting, have concluded that Mr. Snowden is heroic for what it is that he did. The fact that here we are 6 months after the story began, and the interest level around the world is as high as ever, I think is a testament to that. In the U.S., there is very severe polling shifts in terms of people now, for the first time since 9/11, viewing threats to their freedom and privacy from the government as being greater than the threat of terrorism, and all kinds of significant shifts in how people perceive these issues. And I think that continuing to make people aware of not only the severity of the threat, but the reason why it affects them so personally, is instrumental to ensuring that people continue to take an interest in what the government, what governments are doing to their privacy. As far as the question of economic interest, as I indicated in my last response, there have been literally, I think, more than a dozen stories now about programs that have as their only goal spying on economic entities for economic reasons, exactly what the U.S. and the West have criticized China very vocally for doing, is what the U.S., the GCHQ, and its allies are continuously doing as well. And I think, again, I'm hesitant to talk about reporting that we've not yet done, but Europe is by no means exempt when it comes to the U.S. and the GCHQ putting it under a surveillance microscope in terms of trade talks and other kinds of economic interests. And then finally, on the question of a free press, I think it's hard to overstate just how successful the effort has been to intimidate journalists and their sources by the UK and the US. I know I've received all kinds of invitations over the last 3 or 4 months to attend events and speak at events in Europe, at private events, at organizations, at public events before government bodies, and have been advised by all kinds of lawyers that traveling to Europe as a journalist would be very dangerous for me because of the charges that the UK government is threatening to bring as a result of the journalism that I've been doing. And that's true for other people who are serving and working as journalists on this story and on other stories as well. And so I do hope that to the extent that any of you believe that the information that has been revealed has been at all helpful in fulfilling your duties as legislators, that you take steps to protect the journalists and especially the sources who have sacrificed their own interests to bring it all to light.
Thank you. Then now it's the turn of Mr. Kirkhope.
Thank you, Chairman. Good morning, Mr. Greenwald. I assume it is morning where you are. I want to deal perhaps more with the processes than your general observations. I would like to know, really, whether in the in the receipt of information, whether you received a complete copy of the files originally from Mr. Snowden, or whether you got them from an intermediary, additional documents or copies from the Guardian newspaper. And if not originals, did you get separately any other copies from any other source, or a mix of the two? And the documents, you've talked a lot about documents and what they contain. I would like just to press you slightly on this. What were the documents about? Were there signs of redaction, particularly redaction of the names of intelligence agents? And also, you say on your Twitter account that it was the Guardian's decision to give the GCHQ files to the New York Times. I want to know whether you got hold of that information or those files later, or did you already have them? Some people, Mr. Snowden, Mr. Greenwald, regard Mr. Snowden as a hero. I'm afraid I cannot join that club. But the reference to whistleblower, as I understand it, the legal processes of the United States set down clear guidance as to how whistleblowers behave. There are protections for whistleblowers in the American Constitution and legal system. How is it, therefore, that we have no evidence that Mr. Snowden attempted at all to utilize what was legally available to him and, frankly, therefore, left us with a situation that he could actually deal with these matters, you say, telling the world about it? Was that a responsible behavior of a man when security was so important? And finally, as a journalist, Mr. Greenwald, how do you determine yourself what is or what is not a matter of national security? Do you feel yourself qualified or equipped? I know you're no longer with The Guardian. Do you feel yourself equipped and qualified to make such enormous decisions? Thank you.
Mr. Greenwald.
So part of freedom of the press, an important part of freedom of the press that we've been talking about this morning, is that fortunately journalists don't have to answer to government officials about what their sources gave them or how it is that they got the material. They're allowed to protect their sources and to protect their journalistic material from invasions by questions from the government, like some of the ones that you've just asked. Mr. Snowden is the source for the reporting that we've done at The Guardian. Who specifically at The Guardian received the material and when they've received it, I think is not of anyone's concern. Mr. Snowden has been identified as the source because he wanted to be identified as the source. But beyond that, I'm not going to answer questions about exactly when we got the documents or who at The Guardian got the documents or when we decided to share them with one another. Those are our internal matters as journalists and as a newspaper, and it's not for the government to intervene in that process. As far as what the documents are about, I think I've been very clear about what the documents are about. When Mr. Snowden came to us, he said that he had a large number of documents. And if you think about it for a minute, and I think this is really crucial, he had a lot of choices in terms of what he could have done with those documents. He could have uploaded them all to the internet. He could have given them to an organization and asked that organization to disclose it all. He could have sold the documents to foreign intelligence services around the world and been very rich for the rest of his life. He didn't do any of that. He came to journalists that work with the largest and most respected news organizations in the world and asked us to be extremely judicious and careful in going through the material and publishing only that which is in the public interest to know, while not endangering any lives. And I think that everyone can see that we have adhered to those wishes. As far as whistleblower protections are concerned, I'm not really sure where you got the idea that there are protections for whistleblowers in the U.S. Constitution. That's simply untrue. And as far as whether there are protections for whistleblowers in the law, all you have to do is look at the fact that the Obama administration has actually prosecuted under espionage statutes more whistleblowers in the last 5 years than had been prosecuted in all of American history prior to President Obama becoming president. And as I discussed earlier, these mechanisms that exist within the U.S. government are designed to suppress this kind of information and not to enable the public to learn about it. And then finally, as in terms of the question of how I, as a journalist, make these decisions, The answer, the simple answer is I make them the same way that journalists around the world make these kind of decisions every single day. I work with the largest newspapers around the world, Le Monde in France, El Mundo in Spain, the biggest journalistic institutions in Brazil, in Scandinavia, The Guardian, The New York Times and The Washington Post are going through the same process. We consult with experts, we meet with editors, we have a collaborative process, and we make certain that the information that we publish doesn't put anyone's life in danger, and nobody has suggested that the information we publish has done so, but that we do our job as journalists, which is to overcome the desire of politicians to suppress this information and to demonize those people who bring it to light, and make sure that people can know what their governments are doing, because that's what democracy requires.
Thank you. That brings us first to Mrs. Gomez on behalf of the Foreign Affairs Committee, and then I have two more requests for the floor after that. Mrs. Gomez for 2 minutes.
Mr. Greenwald, do you have any evidence that any European leader who has been spied by NSA has been blackmailed or could be blackmailed or intimidated in any way? My second question is, when we went to the United States recently, we found out that the different elements of the administration in Congress were at odds with what would come out. They had no strategy, and they were quite fearful. And at the same time, they were not taking responsibility because there was all this game, well, the president was not aware, he ordered a review, and in Congress the mood was also dismissive. What does it mean? What is there to come? Are we going to learn that NSA has been spying on the US president? Finally, there was a reference to the intelligence, the cooperation with intelligence agencies and the lack of principles and adherence to the rule of law in that cooperation. I'd like to ask you, you mentioned a few more cooperative with the NSA methods. I'd like to ask about my country, Portugal, and if you can't give me an answer now, give me that some other time or some other way. Thank you.
Mr. Greenwald.
Sure. As I've indicated, I'm hesitant to talk about the documents that we haven't yet reported, just because it's irresponsible for me to just start opining on documents that haven't gone through the journalistic process. And so what I will say is that there are still a lot of stories about how the NSA uses and abuses its surveillance power that are not yet reported, but that we are working on. As far as the question of blackmail is concerned, again, I would simply point to history as opposed to what documents might reveal that we haven't yet reported, in which surveillance powers have been abused exactly that way in all sorts of cases. And I think it would be quite naive to assume that suddenly for the first time in human history, a massive surveillance state that operates in the dark isn't being used for those purposes. As far as Portugal is concerned, there's still lots of countries where we intend to do very specific reporting in partnership with media organizations in those countries, and Portugal is one of them. So the only thing I can really say on that is that there is reporting coming regarding Portugal, and unfortunately, since we haven't done the reporting, I'm not able to be more specific.
Thank you. Then I have two final questions. The first one by Mrs. Romero-Lopez, and the last one I'll call is Mr. Engstrom. Mrs. Romero-Lopez from the S&D Group.
Gracias, Señor Green.
Thank you, Mr. Greenwald. Thank you for the work that you've done, which has allowed us to really understand the world that we're living in. I think it's been very helpful. Do you think that the metadata are sensitive data? We've just heard from European experts who've said that basically metadata can give you a time and a place which will allow you to identify a person. If metadata are sensitive data, do you think they should therefore be protected? In your country and in the United Kingdom, are metadata protected? The role of the United Kingdom is very important in this. Do you think metadata should be protected?
You, Mr. Greenwald.
Yeah, I talked earlier about why I actually think that the collection, the mass collection of metadata, is more invasive than even the interception of content, the ability to read people's emails or listening to their telephone calls. And the court decision that we talked about earlier that came out in the United States that found that the NSA's metadata program violated the privacy rights of Americans is extremely compelling about why metadata is so invasive. And I really would encourage you to read it. And what the judge essentially said was that the idea that metadata is simply a list of relatively harmless information is really antiquated. It's from an era where communications were radically different than they are now. Given technology and what we use our phones for and what governments have been able to do in terms of analyzing metadata, metadata really is what the focal point of these surveillance agencies is, because they learn more about metadata, about people from metadata analysis than they do about content interception. And I'm glad you brought up the UK, because when it comes to European metadata, the NSA plays a very important role, but it is the UK, through their interception of underwater fiber optic cables and their invasion into all sorts of systems, including by very controversial means of hacking, as Der Spiegel has reported, that is a primary threat to the privacy of European citizens when it comes to their telephone and email communications, at least as much, if not more so, than the NSA.
Thank you. The last speaker on the list, Mr. Engström.
Thank you. I come from Sweden, and as you know, last week Swedish television showed the program where you were one of the reporters, showing how the Swedish security agency, FRA, are, first of all, very, very intimately connected to the NSA, and second, that they play an active part in actually breaking into computers. And I think that was a new revelation that shocked people in Sweden. And I'm happy to tell you that this has created quite a lot of attention in Sweden. And at the moment we have the government basically saying that they hope that all laws have been followed. So I get the impression that if there are more revelations, that they're planning to distance themselves and be able to blame the security agency itself. So. Yeah, my question would be, will there be more on the Swedish, on the FRA thing? And in general, will there be more reporting on the involvement of European governments? Because I think that's an issue that is of particular interest to us here. And as a last question, you mentioned not jeopardizing lives. Can I feel confident that you're thinking about your own security and the security of everybody else who has access to the material, so that it's not even a theoretical option for security services to suppress the material by killing you off?
Mr. Greenwald.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah, so thank you for that concern, first of all. I'm glad you asked about the Swedish television report, because it leads to a point I wanted to emphasize, which is we spent a long time talking about metadata this morning. But one of the revelations that our reporting in Sweden demonstrated was that the spying, including mass indiscriminate spying, goes far beyond metadata. One of the reports that we did in Sweden was about the program X Key Score, which is a very important program for the NSA and the GCHQ. But they also have now started to allow their closest surveillance partners, such as Sweden, access to this program. And this nothing to do or very little to do with metadata. It's about the ability to store emails and read them at will, to collect people's browsing histories, their chat logs, and their Google searches, essentially the content of communications of what is being done on the internet as well. That is very much a part of how privacy is being invaded. It is not just metadata. There are programs, including Prism, that are all about content and not just metadata. As far as European governments are concerned, it is true, and this was part of how the story evolved, that governments in Germany and France expressed indignation when we did our first reports that the NSA was targeting their countries, only for it to turn out that those countries subject their own populations to similar types of surveillance and even cooperate with the NSA. But at the same time, nobody really competes, certainly not in Europe, with the NSA and the GCHQ when it comes to the level of invasiveness, the amount of resources that go into it, and the objective and the mission to collect all forms of electronic communication. So it is true that a lot of our reporting has been about European governments, and that will continue, but the US and the UK really are on a different level when it comes to both their ability to destroy privacy and their desire to do so. And then finally about my own security and the security of the people reporting on this, we've definitely taken a lot of steps to ensure that there are multiple copies of these documents in various places around the world, very safe and very secure, but that eliminating somebody's ability to work on them would not in any way impede the ability to do the reporting. Reporting on these materials is inevitable. I've been particularly fortunate to be in a country, Brazil, whose government is very appreciative of this reporting and who understands the need to support and protect a free press from the assault by the US and the UK on our ability to do the reporting. And so I think we all feel as confident as we can that this reporting is going to happen and that nobody can stop it.
Okay, thank you very much. With that, we've exhausted our list of speakers. On behalf of this committee, I would like to thank you very much for your time and your willingness to answer our questions. And I think that everybody is waiting with great curiosity and interest for further publications, in particular on the issues that you said you couldn't answer our questions on because it has not yet been published. And as a final remark, I think one of the things that sets a democracy apart from an authoritarian regime is that, yes, we have secret services, but we also have democratic oversight. And clearly, free press plays a role in that, but there is also parliamentary oversight. And we feel that as a European Parliament, we have very limited means to exercise oversight. We do what we can, but of course we'd be extremely grateful for any information if you would feel the urge to share that with somebody, then we'd be very interested. So thank you very much for your time, and that concludes this session. Goodbye. All right, colleagues, it's 25. We have 25 minutes left, and the last item on the agenda is the presentation of the first draft of our rapporteur, Mr. Moraes. But I understand there will be an oral presentation only at this stage, and a text will follow later. Mr. Moraes, you have the floor.
Thanks, Sophie. If I just wait for the mass exodus. I'm not Glenn Greenwald, as you know. I can do this fairly quickly. First of all, just to explain to colleagues, all the shadows who are chatting, doesn't matter. It's okay. No, it's okay. Don't worry. It's okay. You're entitled to chat to the Guardian. It's fine. That's okay. Not anymore. just by way of explanation, all the shadows will receive the report, which I have in my hand, very thick, on Friday. The reason it's a slight postponement is I want to incorporate a number of other issues which have arisen this week, including the analysis of the Federal Court judgment and some other aspects arising from the delegation visit. And we came across a number of other amendments which we needed to make in discussion with the Secretariat, and they are substantive amendments. So with your patience, we're going to do that and give it to the shadows, all the shadow rapporteurs, on Friday. So at least you, if you should so wish, you can read it over Christmas. I'm not compelling anyone to do that. But if you really would like to study that over Christmas, then that's something you can do. But I want to do that because I don't want anyone to feel that we didn't meet our deadlines. That would then take the timetable to schedule a discussion on the 9th of January. Sophie, if that's okay, and then I think the deadline for amendments could remain, if there's no objection, for the 13th of January. I'm happy to shift that, but I think the deadline could remain for the 13th if it goes out on Friday. What I just propose to do now is just to give colleagues a sense of where the report is, and to do that probably most successfully is just to give a sense of what the recommendations would be, which I think is probably the best way to do it. And that's just going to take just a few minutes, and I think that's probably the best way to go through things. To touch on the recommendations, the narrative of the report, of course, we've had the six working group reports, but my report will touch on recommendations which will address the member states, the institutions, and our relationship between the EU and the US. So first of all, in relation to the EU and US, of course, I'm working with the Foreign Affairs Committee, and we finalised our paragraphs with them yesterday. And in relation to that, first of all, the recommendations that I'll be making will talk about continuing our strengthening relationship with Congress, which I think all colleagues recognise was a good thing. We have differences of opinion, but I talk about those sorts of issues. Then the substantive parts of my report in terms of those recommendations. We began the inquiry with journalism, freedom of the press, whistleblowing, and so on. Throughout the inquiry, the LIBE committee began and heard statements from journalists and whistleblowers, from civil society, and the report will therefore call on the Commission to issue a comprehensive report on whistleblowing to include the field of security. On IT security, again, the disclosures have exposed a huge weakness in IT security of EU institutions. Right up until today, we've heard that evidence. It was further highlighted by the reports last month by French newspapers that hackers were able to access MEP and staff emails without much effort. In response to this, the report will talk about review and assessment of technical capabilities, including possible open source software, the use of cloud storage by the Parliament, the impact of increased use of mobile tools, and a plan for the use of encryption technologies. I'll talk about EU cloud computing, recognising the importance of a swift development of the EU cloud as it ensures protections for EU citizens' data, given that any data they store in cloud, the cloud of US companies, can potentially be accessed by the NSA. An EU cloud would ensure that businesses apply the high standards of EU data protection rules. And in addition, I'll look at positive aspects of the disclosures and the potential economic advantage it can bring to EU business. In terms of TTIP, my draft report will recognise the major importance of TTIP, of course, for economic and job growth. However, I will strongly underline, given the importance of rebuilding EU-US trust, that the Parliament should only consent to the final TTIP agreement, provided that there are no references to data protection provisions within the text of the agreement. We need to ensure that strong data privacy protections are achieved separately from TTIP. On the EU-US Data Protection Framework Agreement, the Umbrella Agreement, I'll welcome the Commission's aim of adopting this agreement by spring 2014. The main importance of this is to provide judicial redress for EU citizens when their personal data is transferred to the US. At the moment, the EU citizens, of course, don't enjoy full and reciprocal judicial redress rights, as access to US courts are, of course, guaranteed only to US persons. On top of this, completing the negotiations would restore trust in transatlantic data transfers. On EU data protection reform, I'll talk about specifically calling on the Council to begin work on the data protection package so that an agreement is reached by 2014 at the latest. In addition, I'll reiterate the importance of both the regulation and the directive being adopted as a package. Parliament, of course, has already sent a strong message under this, under the rapporteurship of Jan Albrecht, so it's for the Council to start working immediately, and that will be an important part of my report as well. on TFTP in accordance with the EP resolution. The draft report will call for, or will talk about the suspension of the current TFTP agreement until the conditions as laid out in our resolutions have been met. And it will pursue that narrative, and that's something that colleagues will have to study in terms of their own amendments. On safe harbour, the report will reiterate the message from the working document with Axel Voss on calling on the Commission to suspend the safe harbour principles, which allow US companies to transfer data of EU citizens to the US while providing an adequate level of protection. There are a whole number of other recommendations, but I wanted to cite these recommendations to show that the report is sort of action-orientated and deals with substance, and also follows the narrative of the inquiry, and takes seriously the way that the story of the inquiry went from journalism and whistleblowing through what I thought was an outstanding set of invitations put together by our secretariat and, of course, the shadow rapporteurs right up until today. And I'm trying to follow that narrative in the draft report. Of course, that has to be amended by our shadow rapporteurs and members, many of the active ones who have been coming here to the inquiry, but, of course, some members outside the inquiry too. So that's a taste of the kind of recommendations that will be in the report, but I'll send it out to shadows on Friday, and perhaps they could study it in more detail with the deadline for amendments being on the 13th.
Okay, well, I can't wait until the Christmas break. any members want to come in? Ana Gomez?
Just to say how much I believe the co-raptors of the opinion on AFET appreciated cooperating with Claude Moraes as LIBE rapporteur, and how important it is for us, as he has stressed, this question of asking for the umbrella, pressing for the umbrella agreement on data protection, and in particular making the case for the need for judicial and administrative redress for European citizens in the US. I think from the context we had yesterday with the US Congress delegation, we could see that they do not understand. Some may not understand, but others may not want to understand what we mean. And this is really a crucial question. So I think this is duly highlighted in Claude Moraes' report, and of course I will dispense myself from other considerations at the moment. I think this is a central question.
I'll first invite Axel Voss, who wants to make a remark, and then I want to make one, then we'll come back to the rapporteur. Axel?
Vielen Dank.
Thank you very much. Well, I do get the feeling, especially listening to Claude Moraes, the rapporteur, that we, I think, will achieve a very good result from this report. I'd like to thank the rapporteur, but I'd also like to thank the Secretariat as well for the amount of work that they've done organizing all these hearings over a space of time that perhaps is not a usual way that we carry out our work. So thank you for those endeavors. I also wanted to just point out a different aspect. At the moment, in the Parliament, we're having a discussion on the so-called telecoms package in all its forms. And I think if we're serious about our recommendations, then perhaps the adoption of this package should be postponed until maybe one or another of the points that could be useful by way of our recommendations could feed into that package. And that's why I'd maybe call on the rapporteur just to sound out, just to find out how this might be possible, i.e. that certain recommendations that we're putting down on paper could be realized. And I understand we're under pressure of time, as is always the case at this juncture, but if we want to start implementing something, then perhaps this would provide an opportune moment.
Okay, thank you. Unless any other members want the floor? No. Just two remarks on behalf of my group. One is, and you may have touched upon this, but then it has escaped my attention. But one is, I think many people have seen this inquiry as a traditional parliamentary inquiry where we dig up new evidence. Clearly, that's not the kind of inquiry that we are able to do. But I do think that it is necessary to start the whole report with an overview of what has taken place and in which way that has violated European laws and the rights of European citizens. I think that's important. And the second point, and there's a working document on that, so I suppose that's also going to be an integral part of the report, is indeed on oversight mechanisms who have clearly failed. In some instances they may have worked better, in other instances they've failed completely, but it's clear that there is a challenge there, and not only because of the strength of the oversight mechanisms, but also simply because of the expansion of cross-border cooperation. There is simply something that is escaping the national oversight mechanisms because they simply don't have the powers. And I also felt, as I said in my conclusion to Mr. Greenwald, we seem to be the only parliament that is tackling this whole thing. But of course we are severely constrained by the lack of powers. We cannot hear people under oath. We have no access to classified information. We have the public arena as our only weapon, but I think we should give some very serious thought about the role of this parliament in future oversight mechanisms. If we want more cross-border cooperation, then we also need more oversight, and I hope that's going to be one of the recommendations as well. Okay, well, that basically... Oh, sorry, yes, of course.
Thanks, Sophie. Can I just test your patience for just another minute, just to conclude, Sophie, if that's okay? I was rather not very passionate and very dry in my delivery, I realise, at the beginning. That's only tiredness before Christmas. I just want to say a couple of things. First of all, I deliberately didn't talk about the working documents that all of you have put together. I think this has been a very good exercise because, for example, in oversight or on safe harbour, which Axel is doing, what Jan is doing and so on, and then Anna talked about the Foreign Affairs Committee, I think that has worked very well. But secondly, I do want to make the point that we are dealing with such a sensitive area, and I do want to say to colleagues, and I want to say this publicly in the committee, that it has been a very sensitive issue. We have had quite a few challenges. So I would like to thank my colleagues for their cooperation. It's been a very big test, and it's been quite stressful to thank them. I'd like to also, and Axel made this point, I've seen up close how the Secretariat has worked, Antoine and Jose Manuel and so on, what they did in Washington. I mean, it has been quite an extraordinary effort. You see all these witnesses turning up. This has been quite an extraordinary effort. No other inquiry has put together this much in such a short space of time, and I think colleagues beyond our inquiry have been quite surprised. This is due to their work. It's been a real pleasure working with them. It's just before Christmas. I don't know what they're going to do to me after in January. I'll get dumped. I think it's enhanced the reputations of all of our shadows, and I think we should collectively thank Secretariat for that. I think Antoine and his team have done a brilliant job. And finally, just to say, please analyse what I've done, because my document, which I've very dispassionately talked about deliberately, needs to be taken apart a bit, because it will maybe step into some of your areas. And I'd want this to be a collective parliament inquiry. And finally, Sophie, you said that this is not a court of law. We're not a court of law. We don't take actual evidence. There's going to be a lot of grey areas. So do analyse it, maybe not over Christmas, but analyse it to see where the overlaps are so that we can have some collective piece of work. And Axel, I will look at this telecoms point. I think that's a very good point. And what you're implying in what you've just said is that this EP inquiry, despite what people have been thinking, which had a very low expectation, might have a more substantive recommendation and outcome than we thought. So what I'm going to aim to do is to raise the expectation a little bit, so to have recommendations which might last into the next mandate, so that we set something up that can continue into the next mandate, so make the recommendations a bit strong. So when you view the recommendations I'm making in the report alongside your working documents, have a view to recommendations which last, which are quite strong, so that this is not just like a one-hit wonder, so that something that lasts into the next mandate, that we tell the Commission to do something that is realistic and lasts and so on, that we're a little bit bold. This is what I think I'm perceiving that can be done. So that's the final word I would say. And thank you all just before Christmas. Everyone's tired.
Well, thank you. One last short intervention by Mr. Albrecht.
I just would like to add that I fully agree with the comments and would like to thank personally and on behalf of my group to the rapporteur and to the secretariat for organizing all the hearings. Thank you and good Christmas.
Thank you. Well, I subscribe to that, both extending thanks to the secretariat who've been working like mad, in addition to other big dossiers like the data protection package, and my thanks to the rapporteur. But I think there's still, you know, enough work left in the first months of next year to prevent you from falling into a post-inquiry depression. So, you know, don't worry. I would like to thank everybody, wish everybody excellent holidays and all the best for the new year. And of course, the interpreters, they're included in everybody. I'm looking around. Thank you to the interpreters also for... No, you're not actually staying longer. I think it was foreseen until one. But thank you all the same and all the best wishes for the holidays. And thanks to everybody who's been following this very loyally. I wish you excellent holidays.